out for the Winston Cup stock car title. Today at Rockingham, North Carolina, Earnhardt can clinch his second crown. Three-time champ Waltrip will try to stop him.
One taste of victory and you got to have it again. That championship was good in 1980 and that 86 one was going to be a lot better.
I'm pumped up. It ain't going to be decided here this weekend. It ain't going to be decided in Atlanta. You're going to have to go to Riverside.
TBS Sports presentation of the Nationwise 500 is brought to you by Champion, makers of Copper Plus, America's best spark plug. And by today's Chevrolet, the heartbeat of America, who invite you to put yourself in an 87 Chevrolet and listen to your heartbeat. And by Budweiser, Beechwood Age with that distinctively clean, crisp taste that makes Budweiser the king of beers. For all you do, this Bud's for you.
Well, around this part of the country, folks call this place The Rock. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the STP Pit Communication Center at North Carolina Motor Speedway in Rockingham. I'm Dave Despain. We're glad you're here today because we have tremendous drama as this Winston Cup stock car title chase gets really tense. And we've got great action, great drivers, fender flailing at 150 miles an hour. They're going to run one of the most historic tracks in this sport. The Rock is a good name for this place because it's a hard place. It's hard to drive here. 500 miles seems like you've run for days. And it's hard to finish. The cars get old and worn out and all beat up. But I'll tell you what you've really got at the end of the race. You've got a tremendous victory for the guy who comes to the checkered flag. Now, we're going to get into that title story here in just a moment. But first, I want you to meet the fastest man ever around Rockingham. Our pole sitter is standing by with the senior member of today's broadcast team here on TBS Sports. He's been covering the sport for five decades now. Let's go to Chris Economaki on Pit Road.
I'm with Tim Richmond on the pole here. Tim, it's a must-win situation for you today to stay alive in the championship, and you got your teammate alongside. That's probably a problem for you. How are you going to handle the early stages?
Well, we're going to try to take a lead if we can. We need the five extra points for leading a lap during the race. Then we're just going to settle in and kind of, you know, take it easy on the car and hopefully it'll last until the end and then we'll be all done.
Okay, good luck to you. Across the road to Jerry Garrett with Jeff Bodine.
Well, Tim Richmond's teammate Jeff Bodine's on the outside pole. And Jeff, you've led the first half of the race this year a lot of times, but your teammate seems to lead the second half. You tired of playing the rabbit?
Well, no, we want to play the rabbit again, but we want to put that rabbit in a hole at the end of the race, right in that victory lane hole. So we're going to try the best we can. We think we have a good chance with the Levi Garrett Axtine car. Hi, everybody. Matthew Berry. Love you.
Okay, well, thanks, Jeff. And now the man who will call all the action today at The Rock, Ken Squire.
Well, thank you. Look at it this way. The California Angels are up 3-1. There's only one batter to face, and there's no way the Boston Red Sox can win the American League Series. Right. Well, here today, with three races left, Dale Earnhardt has the advantage over Darrell Waltrip in second place by 159 points, and Tim Richmond in third with 232, and there's no way that Dale Earnhardt can lose the title. Right. The fat lady may not be about to sing, but she's about to clear her throat here in this $400,000 500-mile race. Alongside is the 1973 national champion Benny Parsons. For our live coverage, how do you see the scenario?
Well, it sounds exactly like you said, Ken Squire, that Dale Earnhardt can't lose. But he can. He only has a 159-point lead. And each time Darrell Waltrip has won the championship, he has won this race. If Darrell can go out, dominate, and win this race today, he can win the championship. Ken, let's take a look at the starting lineup.
Going to row number one, Tim Richmond of Ashland, Ohio, on the pole for the seventh time this year. New record for this track, breaking Terry Labonte's mark. Beside him is Jeff Bodine. And that makes the Hendrick team up front once again dominating this race. In row number two, Cale Yarborough, four-time winner of the event, Ford Thunderbird there. And beside him is Ricky Rudd of Chesapeake, Virginia, in the Bud Moore Ford. Going to row three, it's Darrell Waltrip, three-time winner, and each time he went on to win the championship, Neil Bonnet, his teammate, is on the outside of row three. For row four, it's Rusty Wallace from St. Louis, and Harry Gant, desperately in need of a victory here today for the Hal Needham team. Row five, Morgan Shepherd of Conover, North Carolina, and the defending champ, or the 1980 champion, trying to win it again this year, Dale Earnhardt. In row six, Buddy Baker, who's been here since 1965 when Curtis Turner won for every race. And alongside is Bobby Hillen, who won at Talladega, 22 years old. Row seven, Richard Petty. He's been here from the very beginning. He's won it four times. And his stablemate in that row is Terry Labonte, the 1983 champion. In row eight, Bill Elliott, who won this race in 1984, and Joe Ruttman of Upland, California, who carry our onboard camera. In row nine, it's Kyle Petty, and the two-time champion of the event from Hueytown, Alabama, Bobby Allison. Going to row 10, Tommy Allison, Richmond, Virginia, and Dick Trickle of Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin, is here today, and he's qualified well. Going to row number 11 as the field rolls out, Alan Kulwicki was the 12th fastest qualifier, but it was on the second day that he made it. So there he is, starting 21st, and Dave Marcus is alongside. For row 12, it's Ken Schrader and Mike Waltrip. Then in row 13, Buddy Arrington of Martinsville, Virginia, and Bobby Wowak. Row 14 is Jonathan Lee Edwards, South Carolina, and Canada's Trevor Boyce. Row 15, Jimmy Smut Means from Alabama. And Joe Milliken is back out of Randallville, North Carolina. In row 16 today, Mike Skinner and Christiansburg, Virginia's Ronnie Thomas. For row 17, Eddie Bierschwald from San Antonio, Texas, and Bobtail Charlie Baker, the truck driver out of Hanover, PA. In row 18, Johnny Coy Jr., his dad, a great midget driver we watched for many years, and Mike Potter of Tennessee. Row 19 is Tommy Crozier from Virginia and San Diego, California's Mark Stahl. And rounding out the field, J.D. McDuffie of Sanford, North Carolina, and Buddy Boyce of Calgary, Alberta, Canada. And that is the father of the man Trevor Boyce a little further up the field. There's number 26, the Quaker State car, Joe Ruttman of Upland, California, aboard. And there you see the rabbit's foot hanging down there by the mirror. He's hoping for a good run today. Ruttman, who came to third in the Daytona 500 several years back, is hoping he has an excellent day here for the Kenny Bernstein car. Here you see the field approaching turn number one as we get set on a start. Temperature in the 60s today. Beautiful day, clear. Barometer, Benny?
I would say it's probably about 30 and steady. The humidity is probably 60%. Just a perfect day for a race. Rockingham is a tough racetrack. It's a D-shaped oval. There we see it's a D-shaped oval. The length, just over a mile, 1.017 mile. The banking, inconsistent. Turn 1 and 2, 22 degrees. 3 and 4, it's 25 degrees. Each straightaway is banked 9 degrees. The 1 and 2, the 22 degrees is going to cause a problem coming off the second corner. That's where the cars are going to lose the back end more than any other place, and that's probably where we'll have the problems. There we see the length of the straightaways, the front straights a little longer, 1,250 feet because of the D-shape. The back straightaway, just 1,150 feet.
We're one lap away from the start today. 492 laps, the distance of 500 miles. Tough track, this one. Rated one of the toughest on equipment on the entire circuit. And, of course, early in the going, this track has a reputation for trouble. Tight packs and midfield multi-car wrecks have been a fact of life here for many years. Back straightaway again. And that's like a bowling alley if anything goes wrong. Right there, going into turn number three. Field addressing turns three and four down for the start. You're with us live on the Superstation. We're at the Rock, ready to race this afternoon. The battle for the championship, still a question. Earnhardt seems to have the stranglehold on it, but it can get away from him right here today. Front row, the Hendricks team, there once again. Eight of the nine last races has been Bodine or Richmond on the pole. It's Richmond on the pole and diving into the first turn, taking the quick lead. Bodine on the outside and Cale Yarborough with almost a pickup crew. Joey Knuckles and company on the inside going for second place. He's my pick to win today. Benny thinks we're crazy because that team just hasn't had enough time to congeal. Here they are battling down out of the corner as they come around, pulling away to pick up those 5 points for leading
Give it to Richmond. Going to second. Cale Yarborough on the inside.
I picked Jeff Bodine to win the race, and I felt like that first lap run on the outside of Cale Yarborough was pretty doggone impressive.
Here we are back out of turn number two, and you are thrown up against that wall as you come off that second corner. Literally, that grandstand in the back straightaway comes out to greet you there. Here they are coming back out of turn number four, skimming right to the wall. Running the tightest to it is Jeff Bodine. Earnhardt is on the move. He's up behind Harry Gant, tucked in there. There's Richard Petty trying to make a good run today. The youngsters really taking it to the veterans on the 1986 season. There you see Harry Gant at number 33. He almost won here earlier this year, as did Earnhardt in number 3. Back in March, he had this race won on this racetrack until he ran out of gas. 140 mile per hour average as they get this one shook out early.
Ricky Rudd got inside Darrell Walker going down the back straightaway. Took away that spot and took Darrell all the way to the wall. Left that spot open. Rusty Wallace jumped in there. But there we see the front three cars. Tim Richmond, Cale Yarborough, and Jeff Bodine. No one has an advantage. Very equal at this point.
Look at Ricky Rudd pulling into fourth. There's Rusty Wallace coming to fifth spot. As they come back down the main straightaway, lead car, number 25, Richmond stays in front. There he is in that beautiful maroon gold car prepared by Harry Hyde. And the number 5 car goes up to the outside, taking a little higher line on Cale.
Jeff Bodine looked on the outside, had aspirations going by Cale Yarborough. He can make that move. He's going to be trouble today, as I thought he was going to be.
One car running very slowly, main straightaway. Ronnie Thomas may be coming in next time around. Field scurries down the main straightaway. Black flag has been put out on Thomas. Consultation flag on young Ronnie Thomas. Not too young anymore. Dave Thomas, his dad, a great star of NASCAR Winston Cup racing for many years. Back straightaway. Look at Richmond trying to pull away. Gets about a 6-car length advantage. Early in the going, you're live with us here on the Superstation, and out in front is this man trying to hold that lead, and as they continue to rock it down out of the corner, Harry Gant looking very loose for just a moment. The others are back up and keeps going.
He's trying to get inside Darrell Walker when we go down the corner. Walker going extremely high early on in the race.
Meanwhile,
but we're watching the leaders, Tim Richmond. That's Cale Yarborough, second in the white and orange car, and the yellow car is Jeff Bodine.
Now there's the number 3 car, and that's the man to watch. That's Earnhardt going to the inside now, trying to move under Gant. They come off turn 4.
I've been watching Darrell Earnhardt on that line. As you talked about, Benny, running way up at the top of the racetrack. We wondered if it was the car set up or what might be happening. He seems to want to run there. He's made no effort to get down low, but it's not working. He's going backwards. He started 5th. He's back there with Earnhardt, who's trying to get to the front. It's a totally different line than anybody else is running.
You see Waltrip running in 7th place, and there is Gant in 8th, David, and then right behind them comes Earnhardt, and Gant makes another try for 7th place on car number 11, Darrell Waltrip. Must-win situation for Waltrip here today if he has hopes of staying up in the championship battle.
Well, looking at the race from the pit side here, we see that the 3 men who started among the top 10 who have not won a race, Cale Yarborough, Neil Bonnet, and Harry Gant this year, are doing very well. These men do not want to end this season without a victory, and the pressure is on those 3 today. Back to you.
Earnhardt having problems. Morgan Shepherd alongside of him. I watched Earnhardt there. Earnhardt's going high. I watched him a little bit ago. He was smoking some tires coming off that second corner. And this early on in the race, that could be problems for Dale Earnhardt.
Here in the Nationwide 500, that is their own car that's challenging. Morgan Shepherd won the Sandhills 200. And look at that number 3 just ride that track. That car's not handling well.
It isn't handling well. And as I said a moment ago, I saw him smoking tires. That's always an indication you have problems.
They come by. Checking it out, Earnhardt is in the 9th position. Shepherd is in 10th. Buddy Baker, 11th. Richard Petty, 12th. Terry Labonte, 13th. Joe Ruttman is in 14th. Elliott is in 5th. Earnhardt. And here's some lap traffic being gobbled up by the leader, Tim Richmond. Cale Yarborough staying right there with him every stroke of the way.
He sure is. Cale Yarborough, you picked him to win yesterday. I said, no, I don't think so. But so far, so good.
Watch this effort being made further back here in the pack. Now we're back to the leaders for a moment. I'm really interested in seeing what happens with Earnhardt here. They may have just slightly misjudged. You're inside of Joe Ruttman's car now. That is Joe Ruttman running in the 14th position. Now in front of him is Bill Elliott. In fact, he's moved up a spot. Elliott's moved up a spot. He's moved into 14th, and Ruttman is in 15th as they come down by the pack grandstand. Joe Ruttman of the Quaker State car dives into turn number one. And we're live with you for the Nationwise 500 at the Rock. More in a moment.
We're back at the North Carolina Motor Speedway where Tim Richmond, Cale Yarborough, Jeff Bodine comprise the top three. And we've gone under yellow here as the first incident of the day is a spin for Mark Stahl. No serious damage, but we are under yellow and the field will be slowing down. We're in the STP Pit Communication Center where we follow the leaders here on our leaderboard. But there's nobody here right now and there's a reason for that. Come with me. A lot of the top guys in this race are over here doing battle at the front of the field for something called the True Value Hard Charger Award. What is it? Well, it's a wheelbarrow full of cash, and it goes to the drivers who throughout the Winston Cup season charge to the front of the field. They get a cash bonus for leading laps. System works this way. Lead a lap, get 5 points. Second gets 4, 3, 2, and 1 down through 5 places for every lap of the race. So you got to charge all day long. The guy with the most points at the end of the race gets the bonus. The guy with the most points at the end of the year gets a big bonus. We're talking about a total of more than $100,000. So who are the hard chargers? No surprise, is it? Dale Earnhardt, series point leader, also leading in the hard charger standings. Jeff Bodine, as Jerry Garrett mentioned at the top of the show, has been a front runner all year, although the finish positions haven't been here. It's a big gap down to Harry Gant in third. We'll tell you afterwards who wins today's hard charger award.
Activity on pit road. It was an easy spin up in four that brought out the caution on Mark Stahl. And there you see the action continuing down there. Kyle Petty, the last to come out. One lap, and they're going to turn them loose. Among the leaders, the top four did not pit. That would be the Richmond car, the Cale Yarborough car. Bodine, they did not come in. Let's take a look at what happened here.
Well, we just see Mark Stahl, as you said, a lazy spin up between three and four. Got in turn three a little bit too hard. The car comes around. He doesn't go up the racetrack and make any contact with any other cars.
Quickly to Chris Economek. Again, let's try to get Chris Economek.
Well, here's Harry Hyde, the man behind Tim Richmond in car number 25, the strategist. And he has decided not to bring the leadership Richmond in, apparently because he doesn't want to get him back in the track where traffic may trigger an accident. He's out front where the air is clear right now. So Tim Richmond will not be making a stop now. Let's down pit road to Jerry Garrett.
Well, Chris, that's exactly the reason why Dale Earnhardt is still on the track. His crew says they missed a little bit on the handling. Nothing serious, but they would have liked to bring him in for at least outside tires. Here's the start now. Back again to live action.
Alsip is in fifth. Earnhardt is sixth. Morgan Shepherd is in seventh. Buddy Baker eighth. Richard Petty ninth. Bill Elliott in tenth. Bobby Allison 11th. As they go back into turn number one. First caution just completed. And the green comes back out on the 20th lap of 492 to be run. And there you see those front three still deployed as they were. With Richmond first, Yarborough second, Bodine third, and Ricky Rudd in the Bud Moore car maintaining fourth. He's looking pretty stout. Meanwhile, further back, in that battle that's going on for fifth, it's side by side, 3 and 11 going down into the corner. There they are. It's Dale Earnhardt in the 3, rubbing 11 out a little there in turn number 1. As Earnhardt still fights an ill-handling car, did not pit.
He did not pit, and Jerry Garrett is exactly right. He didn't pit because he did not want to get back in the traffic where he was suspect for an accident. And that's probably good thinking on their part, because if anyone can keep up with the car, it's Dale Earnhardt. He's not going to get in trouble, particularly this early on in the race.
The champion racer of the race to be decided. You've got some real racers out here, and one leading right now, Tim Richmond. Now you're back in Ruttman's car. There's Ruttman diving up through traffic. I believe that's Neil Bonnet just in front of him here. He came in and made a 4-tire change, and the Upland, California campaigner who changes teams, the rumor is he may be back with Cliff Stewart, and Stewart may have a new team next year. I'd love to see that happen. Ruttman's such a good driver, so smooth, and things just haven't worked out for him this year. Here he is, down the main straightaway, by the pits, headed into turn number one.
And look at that, those cars going in turn one. Cars all over the racetrack, inside, in the middle, and outside, and trying to figure out where to run and where your competition is going to run. That's so difficult. Jeff Bodine gets the car sideways up in the corner, trying to get under Cale Yarborough, almost lost, and Rudd comes alongside him.
Red and white car number 15, Ricky Rudd out of Chesapeake, Virginia. Bombs down to the inside and slugs it out here. Picks up a spot. Rudd looking really good. Up into third spot. You saw him moving up, Terry Labonte just in front of Ruttman. Terry Labonte had set on the pole 3 times here. He's here on the pole back in the spring when he won the race. Relegated to 14th on the start today. Side by side in the main straightaway. Here comes the number five, Bodine, coming up in a battle for third. Down into the down to far there, the two leaders, and just behind him, there's the battle for third. Bodine is there. Ricky Rudd right with him as that scramble continues.
Jeff Bodine lost that spot, third spot last lap. He took it back on this lap. He and Ricky Rudd trying to change positions every lap.
Whoa, look at Bodine sideways and four, collects it up, had the wind through the door.
And here comes Rudd back on the inside again, trying to take the lead back, going in turn one, and he's alongside Bodine, carries him up the hill, and they almost touch as he exits turn two.
I think he might get a little white-red paint on that yellow-brown and gold-white automobile number five. In that mix also, Earnhardt has been closing up. Dale Earnhardt definitely closing in car number three from sixth position. Jeff Bodine. And now you see just the nose of Earnhardt's car. He closes in on Ricky Rudd. Back behind them, Waltrip, who I'm sure is playing a waiting game. It's early for him.
Dale Earnhardt, in the guy that's got the championship to win, he is running extremely high in these corners, Ken Squire. And the problem with that is there we see a bunch of cars. I think it's Darrell Waltrip, Morgan Shepherd. Waltrip in front, Morgan Shepherd the second car. Bobby Allison is the third car. There's Richard Petty, the 43, the STP Pontiac on the bottom of the racetrack, trying to take away that spot from Bobby Allison.
Petty in ninth.
But I was saying just a moment ago that Earnhardt is running extremely high. It's easy to get a flat tire up there. We see Morgan Shepherd trying to get underneath Darrell Waltrip off turn two.
Battle for six. Waltrip in six. And Morgan Shepherd, who won the Sandhills 200 in P6 yesterday. A lot of enthusiasm over this field here at Rockingham. Biggest advance sale in the track's history, according to Mr. L.G. DeWitt. They've had a record advance, a great crowd out. It's a cool, crisp autumn day here in Rockingham, North Carolina, and you're live on the Superstation as Tim Richmond continues to draw a bead on still another victory in the incredible season that he has amassed since finishing second at Charlotte, North Carolina in the 600. All turned around for his team. Dale Yarborough second, Jeff Bodine third. Richmond out in front. Here's Tim Richmond's race strategy for today.
Well, you're going to have to be patient with the throttle. It seems the tires are giving us a little problem after about 10 laps. The car at times has seemed like it's wanting to get away from you in a real quick hurry. And I think we're going to have to watch that. That's the first thing we're going to have to be careful with. You're going to have to be right on top of a race car with your reaction time, because it seems like the cars want to get away from you a little bit more than normal.
Tim Richmond. And this track has aged a little gray in its tint now, as you see the asphalt here. And here's a good battle for six. Richard Petty moving in, car number 43. I think that's maybe a lap car he's up against.
That's Bobby Allison. They're side by side going in turn three. Richard goes in hard. Allison harder. There's Rusty Wallace, the Pontiac Allgaier Pontiac, right behind those two.
And Wallace has been on the move. He's passed nine cars since the pit stop. He's pulled right back up into contention. Looks real serious. Bobby Allison on the outside in the 22 car, staying in front of Richard Petty. Neil Bonnet beginning to knock on some doors here in the number 12. And on the outside, the Raymond Beadle, car number 27, as they shuffle going down the back straightaway.
Low skin, Squire. Richard Petty squeezed in between Bobby Allison and Rusty Wallace, and that was close. And again, Richard trying to get alongside Bobby Allison next in turn four.
Great shot as they wheeled out here, taking that high line. Now Allison for the moment. Now look at Rusty Wallace. Already has won two races this year. He's one of those new drivers that broke through and took a checker this year. Whoop. Trapped down there for Rudd. He comes out of the throttle, loses two spots. At 27, bucking back is 43 Petty and number 12 Bonnet. Move back up again. Good shuffle going on. At the present time, Bobby Allison in eighth. Richard Petty back to ninth. In the 10th, Neil Bonnet. And Wallace in 11th. Bobby Hillen, of course, a winner, big winner as a new face. And Kyle Petty winning at Richmond earlier on the Superstation this year. Richard Petty, number 43, continuing a good run here today. Petty in car number 43 is in ninth. Remember, he nearly won here in the spring. He led 62 laps and then had trouble, but he really looked good. Finally wound up in third spot in that race that Labonte and Gant finished first and second in. Now Bonnet is trying to go underneath Richard Petty, and he's making his move on the bottom of the racetrack. Bonnet pulling up. It's a good, even Steven fight between these two. Round the left automobile. Petty gets back in front for just a moment. Richard Petty has ditched those old cowboy boots for today's race. What does he say about it?
Well, yeah, at the beginning of the year, they said we're going to start a new, turn over a new leaf. We're going to put a new team back together again. And so they went out and bought me some racing boots, they said. That's what, or booties or whatever they want to call them. And they took me off of the cowboy boot deal for my driving. One thing I have found out about these are a lot lighter, especially when you run a racetrack where you got to be on the gas and on the brake. My leg don't get so tired, so I guess they done right.
I guess so, Richard. That's the man with the longest consecutive race start streak in the business. He's run 448 consecutive races. And who's next on that list? The guy just in front of him, Bobby Allison. 777 total starts without missing a race between Petty and Allison. Let's go to Chris Economaki. He's on pit road.
Well, I've been watching the race, and to me, the sweeper in this race right now is Dale Earnhardt. His car is obviously not handling properly, yet he is holding his position. And when he makes a pit stop, he can get about 95 laps on a tank of gas. They'll fix that condition, and he really should be a rocket once that takes place. It looks to me like he's on his way to a title. Back to you.
Thank you, Chris. There he is, number three, Earnhardt, now running in fifth position. Earnhardt is fourth, Bodine third, Yarborough second, Richmond leading. Earnhardt really pumped up to take this title as he did in 1980, lapping Buddy Arrington.
He's moved down the racetrack from where he was just a few moments ago. The point I was going to make, or tried to make a few moments ago, is that when you run real high on the racetrack, that's where all the small stones are, the debris that comes off the other cars, and that's the place that's the easiest to get a flat tire. There's Harry Gant's wife, Peggy, watching on.
30 laps are now complete. 30 complete. Tim Richmond first, Kaylee Yarborough second, Bodine is in third, and we'll be back with more of the action in a moment.
Eye view of Rockingham, North Carolina's Rock, North Carolina Motor Speedway, and that's where the Nationwise 500 is coming your way live. The man out front all day has been Tim Richmond. An interesting story in second spot. Richmond has won six races this year. Yarborough hasn't won one yet. When you win a race, your car owner gets $100,000 for the following season. It's called the Winner's Circle Program. Sure, Cale would like to win $100,000 for his team, but then again, would he? He's bought his own team for next year. He's going to be changing divisions. Now, let's see, if he doesn't win a race, that means that the guy he's going to have to beat next year, his present car owner, won't get that 100 grand. I wonder what Cale's motivation is. Let's get back to the action.
Let me check one thing. We're now at 40 laps, and plus that, about 45 laps in. We left you, said 30, that's 40. 40 down. And right now, it's still Richmond's race. Richmond's race, and he's building up a pretty healthy advantage out here at the present time. Cale Yarborough and Bodine are beginning to run tight together, and there you see the battle further back. That is Joe Ruttman. Joe Ruttman running in 16th, Bill Elliott in 15th, directly in front of him. Bobby Hillen is in 14th, and the number 9 car had pulled up a couple of times. He had a pretty good deal watching Elliott trying to deal with young Bobby Hillen. There is Bill Elliott back, and as we look from the Quaker State in-car camera of Joe Ruttman, here's the look going down into that corner, up on that banking, lean that car out just a little, making a couple of hitches on the wheel as he moves through, down into the main straightaway comes Ruttman right there with Bill Elliott. Again, Elliott in 15th, Ruttman in 16th, pretty good battle there, and they had been contesting with Bobby Hillen just in front of them. Back with the second place, and that is Cale Yarborough in the Ford Thunderbird, the Rainier Lundy car. Right with him, number 5, Bodine.
Jeff Bodine has caught him again. Looked inside on him coming off turn 4. Now we're going down the back straightaway. That's Yarborough, 28. Jeff Bodine, number 5.
Looks like he's almost willing to... Wow, wait a minute. Cale a bit high, and Bodine snakes it down to the inside.
Can't get alongside. Cale holds him off one more lap.
50 laps complete. 5-0 complete. 50 of 492 now in the book. And there you see the interval briefly between first and second and third. Contest here for second position. I would say that Bodine might be willing to wait a little. It's plenty early in this race.
There's 442 laps to go. But Jeff Bodine is in no rush, believe me. Tim Richmond at the top of the show said he was just going to lead a lap and then sit back and take it easy. But he is taking it easy. In his mind, he's taking it easy. There's just no one that can run as fast as he can.
Well, 7 times this year, those Hendrick cars have locked up the front row, and they did it again here, or 6 times previously today, which is an incredible mark for the Hendrick Racing Stable. Harry Hyde working with Tim Richmond to make that car fly, and, of course, the Nelson crew working and winning in the awards given by Ingersoll Rand for the best pit crew of the year for Jeff Bodine. Locked that up at Charlotte. Now here again is Ruttman closing in on Elliott. Quaker State car down on the inside, almost off the lap car, Jimmy Means. Great pictures from the in-car camera. Snaking by Jimmy Means down on the inside and looking out back, there's Terry Labonte running back in the 17th position.
Those fellas have got to get going because the leader, Tim Richmond, is only about a straightaway behind them. And sure, there's a long ways to go. There's around 450 laps to go, but you can't afford to get a lap down at Rockingham. So they need to get going and pick up the pace if they can at all.
And the pace is about 136 mile per hour average on this mile track as we take a gander out the back and now out the front of that Quaker State car, Joe Ruttman, giving us these great pictures. Here he is right down at the bottom in turn number one and still working on the 1984 winner, Bill Elliott. What a turnaround for Elliott after all those victories last year, 11 in number. And now here he is running back trying to fight off this Quaker State car, find the groove on this track, which has changed considerably. The bear grease is gone. It's a little different grip. Wild ride right to the wall. Socks the pedal down flat. Meanwhile, Richmond up in front, looking very elegant here. Just leading the parade as easily as he pleases. Chris?
Yes. We're 10% into the race now, and I get the feeling that for some reason everybody is either being very cautious or very conservative, whether it's the track and its bad reputation, whether it's important for some drivers to get points in the late season, I don't know. But Benny, maybe you can comment on it. I don't see this vigorous fender-to-fender racing that we expected. Back to you.
Well, you're exactly right, Chris. We haven't seen that fender-to-fender racing because there is 90% of the race left, and there's no point going out and destroying your car at this point in time. They're going to make a few laps, adjust the car, and then the last half of the race, we're going to see some real racing.
You know, a lot of people say, Benny, that the 300-mile mark is kind of crucial. Until 300 miles, you try to stay on the lead lap. Then the last 200 miles, you race. And one of the reasons is to save as much of your race car as possible. The theory is that the guy out front is using up his machine, and the last 200 miles are when the race is won and lost. And that's particularly true for the two real title contenders. Now, Richmond, of course, still has a mathematical chance to win the championship. But Earnhardt and Waltrip are laying back there, playing away. Waiting game, and remember, that's what won it here for Waltrip a year ago.
Clean race by Rockingham standards. We'll give you a resume of the first half with our Valvoline mid-race report just after the halfway juncture here today. Richmond stays out in front. Here he is taking a high line around Buddy Arrington. You're live on the Superstation. Benny Parsons alongside. I'm Ken Squire at the STP Pit Center today. Dave Despain. And along pit road, Chris Economaki and Jerry Garrett. Ooh, trying to take one on the inside. That's Schrader in the Junie Donlevy car up there. Inside and outside, moving through traffic. Wanted to lead a lap and has dominated up toward the 60-lap mark. That has been all Tim Richmond here. There's Trevor Boyce's number 10, diving to the top to get out of the way of the oncoming Tim Richmond.
Richmond still able to keep his car on the bottom of the racetrack. That's where they qualify on him, but he goes a little bit higher in three and four. Jeff Bodine is alongside Cale Yarbrough as they split. Trevor Boyce coming off the fourth corner there. There's Richmond in the shot.
Back into turn number one. As you watch Richmond just behind, we're beginning to develop a pretty good contest. It's 28 and 5. Begin to run side by side for second place. Down the back straightaway. You're watching, and there they are, 28 and 5. First watching Richmond. And now you're back with those second position automobiles.
What happened is Jeff Bodine tried to get alongside Cale as they came off the corner, and Kyle Pettis Ford was there. It blocked Bodine for just a moment. He had to fall behind Cale Yarbrough.
They go in turn number one. Bodine seems to have the power. He's willing to sit on that Rainier Lundy car. The Hendrick stable number five right there with him for that third spot. Ricky Rudd lies in fourth. Earnhardt in fifth. Morgan Shepherd, a very serious sixth. Waltrip in seventh. Bobby Allison, eighth. Richard Petty, ninth. Neil Bonnet into tenth. Buddy Baker, 11th. Baker and Petty have been here since the inception of this race back in 1965 when Curtis Turner came home and the man in first place and the man who is being honored as Grand Marshal today came in third. Ned Jarrett, 20 years ago, Jarrett retired at this particular event. Went out as a champion. Again, the battle for second heats up in turn number four. good scramble continuing as Richmond leads. Down into turn number one, you see them for second place.
See, you know, it looks like we're snake bit. Every time that we leave those two cars, they get side by side. When the camera goes back on them, they're nose to tail as they were just a moment ago. But believe me, folks, they did run side by side for about a lap.
Here we are again, down at turn three. And let's see if he'll try that inside shot. Bodine in the five. Seems to make it work a little better on the inside. Darrell Waltrip in the... There's Darrell Waltrip in the seventh position, taking a very high line. Has this track changed any since the last time you were here, Darrell?
Yeah, it's a little slower. You know, it's another year older. And you can look at the surface itself and tell that it's much whiter now, which means it's faded some, which means it's cured more. So the cars aren't quite as sticking quite as good through the corners. And the only thing is there's no bear grease on it. This thing had a tremendous amount of bear grease on it a couple of years ago. So we can still move around a bit. In other words, we got the higher lane that we can move up into if we want to during the race without having a fear of sliding into the wall. So you're still going to see a pretty decent race, I think.
The father and son combination, Buddy Boyes, is 50 years old. He's the oldest driver in the race, and he's now out of it. He's back in the garage area, one of the first of the retirees this afternoon. I believe overheating's the call on Buddy Boyce's automobile for the Canadian driver. Now there is Walter, still maintaining seventh.
And there's Bobby Allison in the Miller American Buick, right behind Darrell. Just a few laps ago, he was about a half a straightaway behind Darrell. He's gained, he's caught up. There we see Yarbrough Bodine still bumper to bumper.
Tail a little loose there. Looks like that lady had some magic potion she was going to put out. Witchcraft here at Richmond at the Rockingham this afternoon. Perhaps witchcraft on Richmond. She looked like she might have been cheering for Bodine or Cale Yarbrough.
There we see Earnhardt still followed by Morgan Shepherd. This race has been going on for at least 67 laps now. That's when they threw the green flag.
The Nationwise car in the Nationwise 500 stays right there with Earnhardt and continues their little split for the fifth position. Remember that Waltrip is right behind them in sixth. We'll be back with more of the live action from Rockingham in a moment. And Tim Richmond riding roughshod over the field, lapping the 16th place car from inside the Quaker State machine. He just put Labonte a lap down, now puts Rutman a lap down. As he goes on his own way, Tim Richmond this afternoon. He was 11th last year with three top five finishes in the standings, 10th back in 83, third in the current Winston Cup standings. And he's still, I would say if you use that baseball analogy, it's 3-0 for Richmond, 3-1 for Waltrip in the American League Series getting down to the end of it, Benny.
I think that's exactly right. Tim Richmond, 232 points back. He needed for Earnhardt to have a problem early on. We're still early on, but Earnhardt hasn't had any kind of problem so far.
And there you see the relationship back to second and third place. Cale Yarbrough and Jeff Bodine about to put a lap on Terry Labonte, the man who won here in the spring. And things have not gone well for Terry Labonte, who changes teams next year, moves in with Junior Johnson, J.D. McDuffie, one of our old favorites in the Rumpel car. Great big sign in the back for Mr. Rumpel.
Well, that's the Winkle Rumpel Pontiac right now.
Mr. Rumpel has a furniture store, and he's a great McDuffie fan. Everybody has their own sponsors. Some go for millions. And J.D. McDuffie, I think, is racing for a settee today.
Well, the Winkle people bought his car. J.D. is driving for them now. He doesn't own the car anymore, and that's certainly good news for J.D. There, Bodine trying to get alongside Cale, and again he can't do it. Because their slow car was there. Jeff Bodine saw the slow car and said, well, there's no point in me doing that right now. Just wait. Now he's going to try Cale down the Bobby Allison. Bobby Allison, unscheduled stop down pit road.
We saw him beginning to run slowly, and now he has brought it in. Bobby Allison coming to the pit road, had run up to the top 10, then fallen to 15th, and Allison is now having some work done in the motor.
Looks like he, I don't know.
I think it's the motor. I think it's on the right side.
It's something. It's like he's a shock absorber or something. I don't know. They're working on something in the right front of the car.
Try to get a report for you right off on the Stavola brothers. Car number 22 for Bobby Allison. One of only two veterans, the old gang, to win here in 86. These young guys have been eating them up. Now Cale, 28, holding on here, forms his own team for next year, really bought a team. And he's running against Bodine, the man who won at Daytona this year. They stay right there in that second place slugfest. Ricky Rudd staying in fourth. Meanwhile, out in front is this man, Tim Richmond, having his own way as he has ever since we got into the past the first third of the season. Car owner Rick Hendrick really raised some eyebrows when he paired a chief mechanic from another era of the sport completely with a brash young driver, Tim Richmond.
Meet flamboyant young swinger Tim Richmond and irascible old beach race veteran Harry Hyde, the stock car odd couple.
First reaction about working with Harry Hyde was going to jail because I thought they had a city ordinance now in Daytona that we weren't allowed to race on the beach anymore, and I figured that's where Harry wanted to go back to if he got another job.
I didn't know what to think. The first thing entered my mind is I felt like I was too old to start raising up young'uns. I'd done raised two or three of my own, and at first I thought, well, I haven't done anything to Rick to deserve this. But then I got to looking at the guy's record, and he wasn't bad. I thought, if I can shape this guy up, he may turn out to be all right. He may make me look good. So I started working on it, got acquainted with him a little bit better, found out that he is one hell of a driver, and all he needs is a little patience and kindness, and he gives back sometimes more than he receives.
A lot of people had a lot of, not negative comments, but a lot of comments that they didn't think that we would get along because of our age difference and our personalities and stuff. But I knew before we ever got into the game of racing together with Harry and I that we were going to be not only great people to work with and work with one another, but great friends. And you know, it's like my dad. I grew up with Harry Hyde, except his name was Al Richmond.
Tim Richmond out in front, who has won 6 races, 4 seconds in 12 races since they really turned it around here this year. Let's go to Chris.
I'm in Bobby Allison's pit. He just left a few moments ago. The right front shock absorber, this one, broke. The eye broke off. We never hear of this thing happening. The mechanic saw to it, pulled the old one out and put another one in. You can see it's a tough break for Bobby Allison, but these guys are ready for any contingency. Back to you, Ken.
Thank you, Chris. That's the story on what happened to Allison, as we saw a few moments ago. Something amiss, shock absorber problem, as you called it, Ben. Back straight away, it's still. Now, there's a change of position. Morgan Shepherd has moved up into the fifth position, past number three. That is Morgan Shepherd in the 75 car, up over car number three, and has dropped back into sixth. Waltrip is in seventh, Petty is in eighth.
Morgan Shepherd trying to get the low side of the racetrack groove to work. Dale Earnhardt still up on the top of the racetrack, and who knows who's the best way around. All they can do right now is run different lines, let the crews tell them on the radio their time so that they know which is the fastest line for their car. And, you know, the problem is that right now the low groove may be the best in their car, and as the race wears on, it may go up. They've got to keep adjusting their line and their groove as the day wears on.
Now, that's Morgan Shepherd, who won the Sand Hills 200 yesterday. Our Goodrich race report's coming up. More details on that, but it was a great victory for Shepherd yesterday, who's looking very stout in the early going here this afternoon. 86 laps are now complete at Rockingham, and in those 86, Richmond has led all the way, and that's a record for leading the most opening laps in this American 500. Meanwhile, car number 75,
We saw him a moment ago on the bottom of the racetrack. There we saw Morgan as high as he could possibly go in the racetrack, trying to find out if that... See, look at him go up right against the outside retaining wall. Morgan Shepherd trying desperately to find the fast way around the racetrack.
The leader at 134 miles per on the last lap. You saw Ricky Rudd putting Bobby Allison another lap back. Allison was in under green for considerable time. He is off the pace, not with the front runners. Rundown goes like this. Richmond first, Yarborough second, Bodine third, Ricky Rudd fourth, Shepherd fifth, Earnhardt sixth, Waltrip seventh, Petty eighth, Neil Vaught at ninth, and Buddy Baker in tenth.
Oh, there's a spin off the second corner.
Bodine.
Jeff Bodine is fun.
Ooh. And our camera car, the Quaker State car, was directly behind him as he came off that second turn. Jeff Bodine brings out the second caution of the day. Bodine looping as he came off that treacherous second turn. Here at the Rock, car going away, picks it up, caution is out, 89 laps are in the book, We had one brief caution after a spin by Mark Stahl in the early going. Let's take a look at what happened.
It looked like the Jeff Bodine had ideas of getting underneath Cale Yarborough going in the corner, could not make that, decided to go high and just simply lost the car is what it looks like. He is so lucky.
Ooh.
Because that corner is so blind as the competitors come off that corner, they can't see where they're going.
From the in-car camera, here's what Joe Ruttman saw.
Not much. He saw some smoke. He knew there was a car back there someplace, and there he sees the Bodine car. And how lucky Bodine was, if his car had went down the racetrack, Joe Ruttman would had no choice but collect him as he came down.
Which is what happened to Joe, I believe, here in March and a couple of other times this year. Ruttman making the move. Enough smoke out there to give him an indication he'd better get downstairs. That's a hard move to make off the banking because you know those cars are going to try to come across the track. Let's go to Chris Economaki.
Well, Tim Richmond is in the pit. Talk about a timely pit stop. He was going to come in the lap the yellow flag came out. As a consequence, they're changing tires on both sides of the car, giving it fuel, and he's on his way back out. But Bill Elliott has beaten him out of the pit. Back to you, Jerry Sherrod, down the road.
Well, that's exactly the case that Earnhardt was facing. His crew had the tires out on the wall. They were ready for a stop. The yellow flag came out. Everybody smiled. They brought him in and changed all four tires.
The Timing is Everything Award goes to the flagman here. Poor Jeff Bodine spinning as he came out of turn number two. All right, the field gathers themselves back up after we have our second caution today, and it comes at the most fortuitous time because it will keep so many cars up in that lead lap, just about ready to make stops under green. Not the case. Getting ready for a restart in our live coverage on the Superstation from The Rock. More in a moment.
Here at Rockingham, Tim Richmond has already broken the rabbit record. We've just gone back to the green flag. Richmond makes the yellow flag pit stop without giving up the lead. Here in the STP Pit Communication Center, he has not been off the top spot in the heat thus far. The pit stop did one thing under yellow. It shuffled the deck back here in third and fourth. We now have our two real title contenders, Dale Earnhardt and Darrell Waltriper, nose to tail.
95 laps are complete, and there you see Dale Earnhardt moving under Joe Ruttman. Earnhardt is now in third position after caution. From inside Joe Ruttman's car, you're watching as Earnhardt continues an assault on Cale Yarborough for second position. After a short caution, here's how they came out. Richmond first, Yarborough second, Earnhardt third, Waltrip fourth, Rudd fifth, Petty sixth, Shepherd seventh, Baker eighth, Bonnet ninth, Wallace tenth, Bodine 11th, Gant 12th on the lead lap. You're seeing Labonte with Bobby Hillen going a lap down here. The 8 car as the 28 and the 3. Cale Yarborough and Earnhardt scoot under him on the inside. From Joe Ruttman's car. A little dance out of the corner. Down the back stretch. Joe Ruttman in the Quaker State car. Down to the bottom of the racetrack here. Ruttman reported in 16th position at this time. You can see just up in front of him where Earnhardt is closing up and wants to make a run.
Rusty Wallace on pit road, and Earnhardt as Earnhardt tries to get by Cale Yarborough. Rusty Wallace, unscheduled stop, coming down pit road. Earnhardt seems to have his car hooked up a little better right than he did earlier on.
There's Barry Dodson's team over the wall, and apparently a tire problem on number 27. They got one that didn't work.
Looks like a flat tire, or maybe a vibration, maybe a tire out of balance. They
down
are a lap down.
Down the lap. Now there's the 25 car being challenged here by Allison trying to take a lap back.
Bobby Allison is quite a few laps down. I don't know exactly how many.
But after what Earnhardt did in 18 laps at Charlotte, there's hope for everybody. 18 laps, he made up 2 laps, and from the rear, incredible performance. That's the one they're going to talk about for years, that Oakland 500 at Charlotte last time out. That was Earnhardt's race. He just was unbeatable all weekend. He won the Saturday race and came back and won on Sunday. I wonder if that's in Morgan Shepherd's mind today. Shepherd looked as strong yesterday as Earnhardt did on Saturday a couple of weeks ago.
Morgan Shepherd, very impressive yesterday. And I know about Earnhardt making up those laps at Charlotte because, Ken, he made one of those laps up on me. And I didn't want him to do it, but there's nothing I could do about it. He just drove away from it.
Shepherd right now is back in 7th spot. Tim Richmond just racing this track. You know, Harry Heitz is the biggest problem he has with him is getting the car on time. Other people have had that problem as well.
What happened? Okay, I'm down here. This is the tire that was on Rusty Wells is gone for about three laps is all. Watch. Right there is the cut that you can see that sent him to the pitch and sent him a lap down. A little sliver of a cut. Back to you.
Thank you, Chris. That's all it takes to cause havoc on a team running for the championship. 100 laps down.
One concern I've got is Jeff Bodine, as well as he was running earlier on, he had that spin coming off the second corner, and right now doesn't seem to be able to get his car back up to speed like it was before. I don't know if he's encountered some type of problem or he just mired back in traffic right now.
Bodine in ninth. Mired in lap traffic. The second place man, Cale Yarborough, trying to get unlimber Terry Labonte there. Some pretty good stout runners around him. There you see the Richmond car, number 25, holding the lead. And there's Bodine back in ninth, trying to get his problems sorted out today after that wild spin brought out the second caution of the afternoon.
Just doesn't seem to get it going like he had it going earlier on. I don't know if he broke something when he spun over there. There we see Neil Bunn on the inside of Jeff Bodine. Challenges down the front straightaway. They're side by side going in turn one.
Reminder, viewers, will be with you at Riverside, California in the final race. Now look at Bonnet go right up underneath Bodine, and you called it, Benny. Oh, and a spin by Tommy Ellis. Ellis is in trouble.
Oh, getting down the...
Thank goodness.
That is a tough spot to be in. Tommy, very fortunate. No one hit him while he was up there suspended against the outside retaining wall. And it doesn't look as though Tommy Ellis has encountered any damage while he was up there. I don't see any damage at all on the car.
So, after a relatively incident-free race in the replay, you can see Ellis just goes in and the car goes out from underneath him. It's like riding in a swing and all of a sudden the seat disappears from beneath you and there's nothing you can do but wait for something to come in contact with your body.
It looks like he made a little bit of contact with the left rear of the car, but I don't think it's too serious.
Under caution, let's see if anybody's going to dive in here.
I'll tell you who's going to dive in there is Jeff Bodine. I almost guarantee he's going to go in there because his car is just not as good as it was a few moments ago. Yes, there he comes right now down pit road.
And Allison as well as Elliott comes in. Waltrip uses this opportunity, and you can see the green and white car of Harry Gant. Rusty Wallace taking another ride on the pit road.
My son went down to the pit area this morning, came back and told me, Ken Squire, that he felt like Harry Gant in the Skull Bennett was going to win the race today. He had talked to him, and Harry was very optimistic. And if there's anybody down there needs a victory, it's Harry Gant. What a terrible, terrible year he's had.
If I had to pick three, he and Bodine, as well as Yarborough, were the three. Gant not only needs it, but the team is coming. Not only that, but the car owner took the car out to Mexico and won a road race. Of course, it wasn't any competition. It was just 40 cars, Ferraris and Porsches and things that. And he flat put it on them. But now they're back to real racing here. And Gant does not want to have his leader going out getting checkered flags in the year when he hasn't had one. A GM Goodwrench report on racing around the country. Let's go to that right now. Standing by at the GM Goodwrench Center is Bob Barsham.
Thank you, Ken. The Kart IndyCar title chase visits Phoenix International Raceway in Arizona this afternoon. Bobby Rahal has fattened his points lead to 10 by taking the pole. Rick Mears is alongside. Runner-up in the points, Michael Andretti crashed his primary car in practice, but he qualified his backup fifth. At Road Atlanta, the Sports Car Club of America National runoffs reached their climax this afternoon as actor-driver Paul Newman goes for his third straight GT class title. Here's a look at yesterday's highlights.
577 entries make this the biggest field in runoffs history. By the end of the weekend, 22 national champions will be crowned, including Formula Ford, here won by California's Jim Vassar Jr. In other events, showroom stock honors went to Ohio's Bob Strange in a Porsche 944 Turbo. The worst incident of the weekend came yesterday when GT4 driver Mike Lipscomb crashed hard and had to be cut from his car. He was taken to a local hospital and later released. As usual, protests and a couple of disqualifications have spiced the action. Look for a full report next Saturday afternoon on Motor Week Illustrated.
We're racing back here at Rockingham. Let's go back now to Ken Squire.
Just under green, 108 laps complete. Tim Richmond out in front, and he has some lap cars, or a lap car. Terry Labonte sandwiched between himself and Cale Yarborough in second place. Dale Earnhardt is in third. Ricky Rudd is in fourth. And how about this? The King, Richard Petty, is back in the fifth position.
Yes. Cale Yarborough trying to get alongside Terry Labonte's exit turn two. Labonte wants to stay up there in case there's a caution flag. Try to outrun Tim Richmond back to the start-finish line and make up a complete mile on him.
Cale getting nailed. by the number three, Earnhardt, as they went into turn number three. That doesn't bother Cale very much. He just drove away, and as you can see, pulls off to about a three-car length advantage. Terry Labonte's problems seem to be resolved. He's running right up with the others now after dropping a lap down on the leader. Pit stop helped him a little.
The 33 car of Harry Gantt seems to be having some type of problem back in the field, but we're watching the leaders right now. And Dale Earnhardt trying to get by Cale Yarbrough, trying to get up front. He told me yesterday afternoon that he wants to get up front and lead a lap because there is five extra Winston Cup points if he can just lead one lap, and he wants to do that desperately.
And a savvy race is being driven by Ricky Rudd back and forth spot. The Bud Moore car just stays in there, that red and white car, back into the picture. Here he comes, Rudd in fourth, and he has stayed in fourth most of the afternoon. Now you see Earnhardt taking the high line another time, using up a lot of racetracks, gets a little more RPM, uses up a lot more space. To stay the fast way around, if he can make it work, he's on the bottom of the racetrack. Tim Richmond has proven that through 111 of the 492 laps thus far.
But behind Richard Petty, who is right behind Ricky Rudd, there is a tremendous race going on with about eight or nine cars.
Indeed it is.
Morgan
Richard Petty is being
back.
Challenged by Morgan, by Baker, by Waltrip. There you see the Petty car, number 43, that old familiar color. And then back about six car lengths from them, Haiti bar the door.
Oh, Darrell Waltrip right there.
Morgan Shepherd right behind Richard Petty by about seven car lengths, and he has his hands full. Let's go back and take a gander at that. Now there is Morgan Shepherd in the 75, and Buddy Baker is right there with him. And Shepherd, it looks like he's been loose a little. Here's Walker coming to the inside.
And here's Walker trying to get that spot on the inside. He's alongside Buddy Baker.
Walker's up for seven. Ooh, tight running.
Ooh, very tight running. Earnhardt started to stick his nose along in between Terry Labonte and Cale Yarbrough and thought better of it, and it's a good thing.
Back in second place is this struggle, and it's Earnhardt on the outside, making the move. He's up there. Here comes Yarbrough back another time. Winston Cup, the most competitive automobile racing in the world, and wherever you gander, watch to see from a competition standpoint on this mile track, The Rock, North Carolina Motor Speedway. Number 15, deployed back there in the fourth position, Ricky Rudd continues to be a very fast observer. Nothing casual about this. He stays right there, and he's determined to just wait it out in that fourth spot. I don't think he wants to go any further at this time, but he doesn't want to go any further back either.
No, that's right. He wants to stay exactly where he is. And I think Earnhardt right now, once he's got by Cale Yarbrough, I think he wants to get up to Tim Richmond and take the lead. As I mentioned a moment ago, he wants those five bonus points.
Now remember, it's a beautiful golden day here in North Carolina. The temperature's in the 60s, which is perfect for these drivers. Now there you see a lap coming up on Terry Labonte as Earnhardt continues to really ride this racetrack.
Clock down here, watching him with a stopwatch, how the leaders are running. Before that series of yellow flags, Tim Richmond was clicking them off with wonderful consistency. 27-12, 27-10, that's 27.10, 27.12. Very, very consistent. They made the stop, they put on the tires, they fueled the car. He went back out and started running in the mid-26-second bracket. He really picked up the pace. I think Earnhardt knows it. Earnhardt doesn't want to let him get away. Earnhardt didn't want to mess around with Cale. It was time to push the button, time to go, time to see what Tim Richmond really has. Nobody's challenged him. He has led 117 consecutive laps from the green flag. It's an unbelievable Rockingham performance. I think Earnhardt's decided it's time to go up there and put a dent in Tim Richmond's rock.
There's Earnhardt. In the second position, Cale Yarbrough now back in third spot. The war of the words last year between Waltrip and Elliott might have had a psychological effect on Bill Elliott, but it has had no effect this year on the man that drives car number three. In fact, as it stands now, it seems to be almost an enjoyment for Darrell Waltrip in that war, for Dale Earnhardt in that war of words with Darrell Waltrip.
On the racetrack, off the racetrack, Darrell's a competitive race driver. He likes to talk, and you know, he'll do everything he can to try to break your little barrier down or little edge and get the advantage. And we've done real well in keeping the advantage on our side, and I think we can hold him off three more races.
Doing that very nicely now, although moving up is Waltrip. Waltrip is up into fifth. He just passed Richard Petty. move Petty back to sixth position. Good scramble going on there. Waltrip seems to have sorted that car out and picked his speed up a little. There you see Waltrip continuing to move up through, challenging and getting under Ricky Rudd, and he's in the fourth position, Ben.
Went right by Ricky Rudd like there was nothing to it. So, and he's gaining on Kyle Yarborough. So Darrell Waltrip, evidently on the change of pit stops, he's found what he's looking for on the bottom of the racetrack, and he's only one of the few cars down there.
Got a great battle developing between Yarborough and Waltrip, and we'll be back for the action in just a moment. Live action from North Carolina Motor Speedway on the Superstation. At the moment, pits Cale Yarborough in third against Darrell Waltrip, number 11, riding fourth. 126 laps are complete, and the last five laps have highlighted this battle before what appears to be a record crowd at the North Carolina Motor Speedway. On this one-mile banked asphalt, it's been Waltrip diving underneath, pulling up almost to the door, then falling back a length or two.
Yes, Waltrip able to run on the bottom side of the racetrack. The groove is high. All the cars are running high except Darrell Waltrip. He's on the bottom. And let's face it, the bottom is the fastest way around if he can just stay down there.
Now, Bodine has fallen back. Remember, he was right up in the midst of things. And I believe Chris Economac, you can tell us what's the story on Jeff Bodine's car.
Well, I will see with Gary Nelson. He just stepped away. We'll have to get him later. But it's interesting to know that when you check the statistics of this fall race in Rockingham, for the last 7 years, the driver who led the most laps only won once. And Tim Richmond has led the first quarter of this round. I'll be back when I find Gary Nelson.
Bodine is now being shown an eighth spot in car number five. Meanwhile, in that third position battle, it continues to be Cale and Waltrip in a ding-dong affair. Just barely to the inside. Pulls right back in there, but not enough. Now maybe enough. He's mustering some more strength, and he's to the bottom of the track. Waltrip pulls up, running wheel-to-wheel with Cale Yarborough, the three-time Winston Cup champion on the inside as well as the outside. Cale, the man that did it 3 years back-to-back for Junior Johnson, and of course, Waltrip has now won it starting the 80s here. First and second, showing a 3 2/10 second interval between Richmond and Earnhardt. There you see Earnhardt in the second spot.
Earnhardt's having problems getting by the Oldsmobile of Terry Labonte. He drives up on the outside of him, not able to get by. There we watch Cale. There we see Earnhardt is alongside the Labonte Oldsmobile right now. They exit turn two. Labonte had to back off just a moment for Jonathan Edwards, and Earnhardt able to take that spot away. That was not a race for position. Terry Labonte is a lap down.
Just trucking through traffic here this afternoon at Rockingham, North Carolina. Whoa, trouble up in turn number two. In the second turn, one loose and coming down, or actually it's almost between one and two, where car number 48 comes to the bottom of the racetrack. Johnny Coy, originally out of New England, came down and worked as a crew chief, wanted to be a racer, and he shortened that one up a tad.
He has made some pretty heavy contact with the outside retaining wall. See, we see the left rear just almost dragging the ground, maybe dragging the ground, as a matter of fact.
Fourth caution of the day. Immediately, Tommy Ellis dives into the pits, and that may be premature. They're racing back to the line. Ellis is not only going back to the pits, he's headed for the garage. Something seriously wrong with this car. Now, they split the pits here at Rockingham. Some pit on the back side of the track, and there's the incident that's brought out the fourth yellow flag of the afternoon is Johnny Coy Jr.
How fortunate these cars are you've had three instances where the cars went in the corner, lost it, and spun, come back across the racetrack, and no one hit them going in and coming off.
Well, there you can see him ricocheting along the wall. Looks like that all happened under his lonesome, all by himself. And now we watch all the leaders come down pit road. Richmond, Cale, Earnhardt, Waltrip, Ricky Rudd. Here's Jerry Garrett.
Well, we're down here at Dale Earnhardt's pit right now, Ken, and they're putting on right-side tires. They're not going to make any chassis adjustments. They really haven't laid a wrench in this car all day, so they must be fairly satisfied. Now they're going around the left side to change the other side tires. All four for Dale Earnhardt here. I guess that they decided they got enough time here on this yellow to get them all in. And he's away.
That was a great pit stop by the Richard Childress crew.
10th place or better in the last three races of the year, and Earnhardt's home.
Earnhardt takes the lead in the exchange of pit stops, beats Tim Richmond out. But Morgan Shepherd even beat those out, so Morgan Shepherd the leader right now.
Give Morgan first place in the Nationwise car.
I would dare say that Morgan probably only changed two tires, probably changed the right side, where the Earnhardt and Richmond crews did change four tires.
Down to Chris.
Okay, we were just down here watching Jeff Bodine stuff. He had a passenger for, it seemed like 5 minutes. A man got in the car, must have taken 10 turns of wedge on the left rear corner, and they changed four tires, so they really sent Jeff Bodine back on the track with a different car than the one he came in with. Back to you.
Chris, was that the problem? Was it was in the handle on that car?
That's right. This guy, I never saw so much adjustment put in one corner. The man got in the car, he went over the wall with a wrench in his mouth and two tires. And he spent the longest time working on that left rear adjusting post over the left rear wheel. Back out there now. Let's hope it works for him.
Well, there you see Bodine back on the track. As we haven't sorted out now, it's 11th position. This caution came at the 133rd lap. 133, they put the yellow out. Won't be long before they get this race back underway. Almost nothing on the track. I'm sure within a lap we're going to see it go. Let's go back to the STP pit center. Here's Dave Despain.
One of the things we do here is keep track of who is really turning in the outstanding performance of the race, because at the end of the race, just like on Motor Week, we have to pick our champion spark plug performer of the event, or of the week, in this case, the racer of the race. For the first 130 laps of this race, nominations were not open because there was only one guy in contention. Jim Richmond led it all the way, but now we've had the scramble with the pit stop. Richmond's back in third. This deck may shuffle a little more as the secondary pit stops are made, but I got a battle right here that I think is going to be interesting. Waltrip is right on the heels of it. Shepard for the moment at the top of the heap, and Jerry Garrett is on pit road.
We're down here with Richard Childress. Richard, what does Dale say about the car?
Well, it was feeling pretty good there. We, you know, we got the right tires on it now. We got our qualifying tires off and got those on, and he says it's feeling pretty good right there. We'll just have to wait and see.
I haven't seen you lay a wrench on the car yet.
No, we, you know, we just have to see how the track changes and how everything changes around, and then we'll know which way to go with it.
Want to get up there now and lead that lap, get that 5-point bonus?
Yeah, we're going to try.
Okay, that's the word. Dale Earnhardt Smith.
Down here at the main straightaway, one of the NASCAR safety trucks was out getting some debris just at the entrance to pit road on the speedway up against the concrete wall. They found something. They've taken an extra lap or two. That was not where the incident took place.
That was probably a thigh bone from some of the chicken that the people up in the fans were eating as they, when they got through, they just chunked it down on the racetrack.
I'll tell you what, you don't want to run on over one of those either. Restart getting ready. Morgan Shepherd is first, Earnhardt is second, Richmond third, Waltrip fourth, Yarborough fifth, Ricky Rudd sixth, Baker seventh, Richard Petty eighth, Neil Bonnett ninth. More from The Rock in a moment. Back under green, a couple of laps gone by. Dale Earnhardt has sprung out in front to collect those 5 points for leading a lap here. For a moment, Terry Labonte had made up the lap that he was down in the number 44 Piedmont car. Now he has succumbed to the efforts of Dale Earnhardt, and again, he is looking up from under. Terry Labonte wanting very much to get back into that lead lap on a track in which he has done very well. Now you're inside of the Quaker State car another time. You're riding with Joe Ruttman back in the 14th position. Bill Elliott up there in 13th position, and that is Tim Richmond up there. He's right on the tail end of things. Richmond is in second place. Ruttman running a lap down to those leaders. Giving you a view of the challenge being made by Tim Richmond to get back up on top in this event.
Ruttman just motioned to somebody to pass him on the outside. That's Cale Yarborough behind him. And Joe had made the, it looks like the way that Ruttman is running that lap, that he was going to go high. He wanted Cale to go on the inside.
Yeah, that's the story. There's Cale coming up on the bottom. I just see a little nose of that car about 150, 60 miles an hour. On this mile oval, and also back in there, you see the number 11 car of Waltrip, which is deployed in fourth position. It's live here on the Superstation. Great pictures from the Quaker State car of Joe Ruttman as he hangs it on the outside, gives the bottom to the guys in the lead left. That's Cale Yarborough in third, Darrell Waltrip in fourth.
Yarborough almost dropped hit by Darrell Waltrip down in the third and fourth corner just a moment ago.
Look at Baker in 88. Buddy Baker has never won this race. And from Joe Ruttman's viewpoint, there goes Cale. 3,700-pound cars to be 3,500-pound race cars next year. What do you think that 200 pounds off these cars is going to amount to, Jenny?
I don't think it's going to make a great deal of difference, but it's probably going to make a difference at some of the racetracks where we, in fact, are having tire problems. Where we're blistering tires, it may eliminate that problem. I certainly hope it does.
Well, here's Buddy Baker with his Oldsmobile, number 88, closing up on Ruffin to try to put him a lap down and to continue his counterattack up on car number 11, Waltrip. He's come close here on occasion, but he's never won in this race, and he and Petty are the men that have been here from the very beginning. They've never missed a race, so the story goes, 1965. Buddy Baker wheels around, holding on to fifth position. Petty is in sixth. Morgan Shepherd has fallen to seventh. Neil Bonnet is in eighth. Ricky Rudd is in ninth. Bodine now tenth. Gant is in 11th. Terry Labonte in 12th. Labonte a lap down.
Terry Labonte trying to, but he's off the pace. Yarborough goes by him. Right now, we have a race. We see the 25 car. That's Tim Richmond alongside Bill Elliott.
Elliott's in 12th.
As they come off the second corner, Elliott is a lap down. He wants to stay up there, try to get his lap back, but Richmond wants to get by him so he can go up and play with Dale Earnhardt. Because these two guys do like to play. They like to run side by side, bump each other.
You watch Bill Elliott, you remember a year ago, he was the guy in the title hot seat. He was the point leader coming in here with Darrell Waltrip chasing all over him. His number 9 car was the hottest thing in the sport, and it was right here in Rockingham that he had the tangle with Richard Petty, tore up his car, he didn't finish. Waltrip won the race, went on and took the championship. Elliott is not having near that kind of a season this year, but I think what that points up is how quickly things can change when you're a title contender, and right now at Rockingham, the two front runners in the championship, Earnhardt and Waltrip, are right up there in the thick of that top five.
Well, Cale Yarborough is really coming in here, Dave. He is running right behind Richmond, and he's not giving ground to anybody today. He's had some terrible luck here, and he's had some good moments at this track. Here's Cale down on the inside, challenging Richmond, who was loose for just a moment. Cale on the bottom of the racetrack. This is the battle for second position. Wheel to wheel across the start-finish line into turn number one. The Timmonsville Terror, Cale Yarborough, running Tim Richmond high as they come out of turn number two. Still side by side into the back straightaway.
Cale, not to let go. He does not want to be denied. He wants that spot, but there's nothing he can do. Richmond a little bit too strong coming off the second corner. But no, Cale comes back once again. They're side by side coming off turn four.
Still wheel to wheel. Yarborough on the inside. Richmond on the outside. Great racing here, and you're seeing it live on the Superstation. Cale Yarborough bottom, looks like he has the advantage, holds it out in front, and takes that second position away from Tim Richmond. How much is racing luck a part of winning at the Rock? This is what Cale told us.
Well, luck is a part of winning everywhere anymore. The competition is so keen. If you have a little bit of bad luck during a race, you're caught behind, and it's hard to catch up anymore. But here at Rockingham, it's really tough. If you get behind here, it's almost impossible to catch up or make up any time. So you better have a lot of racing luck here with you if you're going to win this race.
Oh, that's a sad one. Helen Ray Carr, Dave Marcus, erupts an engine in turn number one. That's the fifth caution of the afternoon. Oh, what a hard moment for a hard racer. Dave Marcus. Saw him this morning about 7 o'clock leaving the motel, and said, boy, I really hope you have a good day. And he said, boy, we really need one. Not to be. That's unfortunate for Dave Marcus, bringing the colors back. We'll have a replay to look at here.
There we see the engine going, and Ken, that's a colossal blown engine. I mean, that is big time blown engine. We're talking about throwing everything except the carburetor away with that one.
That's a lot of souvenir parts. That's all that one is.
Looks like the car's still running. I don't really know. As we watch him go down the front straightaway.
Or else he's got a jet engine, one or the other. I think he was pitting on the back side. He comes down pit road, comes out again.
There's some heavy smoke coming out the exhaust pipe by the left side. I would think that he's broken a piston or something inside the engine.
Maybe sprains or mosquitoes here. A little chilly for those today. The temperature's in the 60s. There you see Earnhardt back in. Now we've experienced 5 cautions thus far in the race. That's nowhere near the record. How about 14 back in 1981? Here's Chris.
Oh,
Okay, Tim Richmond just made a pit stop here, and nothing was done to the car. Putting on new tires and refueling. That tells me that the car is just as good as it can be for Tim Richmond. The fact that others are in front of it means that their cars have been caught up. Their cars are now correct, where earlier they weren't. So we have a lot of evenly matched cars at the front of the pack today, and it should be a better race from here on in. Back to you, Ken.
So the latest caution comes at lap 155, 153, and it's for car number 71, Dave Marcus. His engine came unhitched. Beautiful day here at the North Carolina Motor Speedway. And remember, we'll have a mid-race report for you, courtesy of Valvoline. So if you're just joining us here, we'll update you on what's happened, major incidents of the first half of the race, and take a look at a rundown. That's a little later on. I mean, a little later on. Not that far, actually.
What happened this Morgan Shepherd did not pit. Neither did the 15 car, Ricky Rudd. So these fellows right now are the leaders, man.
246 laps will make the halfway distance. And we'll be back here at North Carolina Motor Speedway for the running of the Nationwise 500 in just a moment.
Back live at North Carolina Motor Speedway, where the Nationwise Rockingham 500 continues. You know, they give a hard luck award in this race. This guy right now, to get my vote, would be Harry Gant. Harry mounted up 8 sets of tires for this race. It's only 150 laps through it. He's already used 6 sets. Still haven't got the handling right. They just came in just a few minutes ago and changed the left front shock absorber. They think that was the problem.
And they're back in another time. They almost won a lap down. They scurried back out, made a loop around the track, and they're back in for additional work on car number 33.
Probably what they did, Ken Squire, was take the shock absorber off on the first pit stop, and now they're back in putting a new one back on.
Travis Carter and company trying to keep this one going. Really in desperate straits to get a victory as far as they're concerned, just for team morale. They want this one. They wanted Charlotte badly, too. Of course, they had a victory back there in 82, and they'd like to get something going for this afternoon.
Not only team morale, but it's very expensive not for them to, if they don't win a race, we're talking about $150,000.
Yeah, they're going to come off plan one.
That's right, $150,000 for a year, so yeah, they need to win.
Well, there he is, catching up with the field again, and he'll move back up and stay in the lead lap. And on these restarts, I think Benny has pointed out many a time before, the fast cars in the lead lap will be on the outside, and lap cars will be on the inside as they resume racing here at Rockingham today. You're back in Joe Ruttman's car, now in 14th position. Rundown goes like this. Morgan Shepherd is first. Ricky Rudd is in second. Neil Bonnett third. Dale Earnhardt is fourth. Waltrip is fifth. Kaley Yarborough sixth. Tim Richmond is seventh. Richard Petty is in eighth. Baker ninth. Bodine tenth. The 11th spot is Gant, 12th is Elliott, 13th Labonte, 14th Ruttman, 15th Wallace, 16th Hillen, and running 17th is Kyle Petty.
Harold Kinder, the official starter for NASCAR, giving the field one lap to go. The next time by, he's going to go throw the green flag, and this field is going back racing. This is the furthest back that Tim Richmond has been all day. He's back in 7th spot right now. I think it's going to be very interesting to see how Richmond does going to the front.
Field tightens up in the back straightaway, ready for a restart. Don't forget, we'll be with you at Riverside, California, for the season finale on that road course. How come you decided to race in that one and not join us?
Well, I wanted to join you, but there's a little more money to be made on the race
track.
I mean, I like the Ken Squire, but you know, liking can only go so far.
You and Richmond put on a show unto yourselves there 2 or 3 years ago.
And I hope we can again this year.
You still owe him one?
I still owe him two.
Down we come. Restart here at Rockingham. And as they try to break up through, Joe Ruttman dives all the way to the very bottom of the racetrack. He was almost in the grass as he scurried across the line.
And I'm looking out at the NASCAR official, and Joe Ruttman is going to get a black flag the next time by. The official said he jumped the start.
Ah. And they have a sign down here which they would put up. There's Ruttman going down into the back straightaway. Directly in front of him, Rusty Wallace. And as they come down, let's see what they're flashing. It's 26 on that signboard. Car number 75 getting a bit high for just a moment. Gets it back under control. As he came off, that was Morgan Shepherd making his run. He's in the lead. Ricky Rudd in that second spot. Here they are back down out of turn number four.
Very interesting right now because we've got all kinds of situations on the racetrack. We've got there Joe Rutman acknowledging his black flag, comes in the pits. All he's got to do is stop. The official says, go ahead. He's back on the racetrack. But he loses almost a lap doing this.
Now you're with Joe as he comes back down pit road and tries to come back onto the speedway. Let's go to Chris.
I'm down in the Goodyear area here. These men are waiting to get all of these tires, and we counted 52 of them, waiting to be mounted, put the pressure in the balance. The number of yellow flags and the tremendous competition. Every time a car stops, they take off the tires and put new ones on, and everybody has a day off that's watching this race except the guys at Goodyear. Are they ever working overtime today? Back to you.
So tires will be an issue here today. That seems to be the story that's been developing from what we heard on Harry Gant and the latest report from Chris Economaki. Shepard in front. Now you see Ricky Rudd in second.
Ricky Rudd starts to put a little heat on Morgan Shepard as he goes down in turn one.
Earnhardt has gone into third. And here comes Ricky Rudd down to the inside.
Down the back straightaway, he looks inside the 75 car. But no, Morgan Shepard dives down low, keeps Ricky Rudd back, and Earnhardt, here he comes. He's right on the back bumper of Ricky Rudd.
This is for the lead. Live on the Superstation. Nationwise, American 500. From Rockingham, North Carolina, back on the inside, going into the corner, easing out of the throttle there. It's car number 15, Ricky Rudd, and let's see what will happen with Earnhardt trying it. He does not ease back. He just gets his shoulder down on the inside, keeps Rudd on the outside as they go into turn three.
Earnhardt, the only one of those three who stopped and got new tires, and we can see the advantage that the new tires has over the old tires. Earnhardt able to do the things that Ricky Rudd could not do with Morgan Shepard.
Cale Yarborough getting by him, slowing down.
70 to 25, Tim Richmond slowing down.
Richmond in turn number one looked to be off the pace. He's falling back as he comes into turn number two. Here you see Wallace collecting him. Alan Kowicki right in there behind. Baker is up there. Here comes Bodine. And I think something is amiss on Richmond's car. He definitely came off the pace.
Tim Richmond definitely has a problem. He looked at pit road that time, chose not to go in.
And he is really slowing going into turn number one. Off his feet is Tim Richmond. Falling further and further back. I'm sure he'll pit this time.
Oh, he's
out of control. A tire, that's for sure.
He has a flat tire, almost spun it. What a great job by Tim Richmond saving that car coming off turn two.
Richmond had it right on the edge, and it looked like if he lost it, he was going to collect five or six automobiles. Made a remarkable recovery. Here he is getting it down into the pit. That's why he didn't want to make any fancy moves, any jerky moves in that steering wheel, and didn't attempt to pit earlier for fear that what might happen almost happened out of turn number two. Potential for disaster. He rode it down, gets it in. Chris is there.
Okay, they're now looking to see which tire it is that's flat. It's apparently on the outside. The car's not been jacked up yet.
It has broken a rear sway bar, Chris. The rear stabilizer bar is broken.
Oh, that's what it is. Anyway, Rick McKesson. And Harry Hyde is standing by the right rear wheel. We can't see it from our position here. And now they still haven't diagnosed the problem as yet.
Well, that is really serious,
and
Chris.
There's a fire in the left rear corner. The left rear brakes are on fire here. And then they've got a fire extinguisher here. So apparently there's a problem on the underside of the car. Richmond is sitting calmly at the wheel. And they're going to push the car here at the outside. We'll get a word with Tim as soon as they bring the car to a stop. Find out just what that trouble is.
That is even more serious.
Yeah, it's a serious problem.
That happened to Dave Marcus.
Tim, you know what the trouble is?
The wheel bearing. Harry just said on the radio, I think it's the wheel bearing. I'm about starting to act up, and I'm about busting my can over there off of two with this lucky 7-1-piece.
Okay, there you hear from Tim Richmond, the wheel bearing, and he said he almost hit the fence over there. And you can see the work that they're doing on that left rear corner of the car. Tough break for the man who sits on the pole. And this, of course, means the championship will be out of his grasp. After this long repair job, it's a tough break for a nice guy. Look at the smoke and so forth coming out. It's red hot stuff. And that man is in there now working against those red hot pieces. They're going to change the wheel bearing, and that's a long process. There they're spraying fire extinguisher material, which is a coolant to cool down the parts so that they can get their fingers and tools on them. It's going to be a long time here. We'll report from time to time. Back to you, Ken.
You know, Chris called this earlier in the race. The last six runnings of this event, the guy who led the most laps has won it only one time. The odds were 6-1 against Tim Richmond coming into the event of him being able to keep that championship alive. As the lead battle continues, Richmond is out of it. It'll be Darrell Waltrip and this guy, number three, Dale Earnhardt, who will decide the championship for 1986.
Dale Earnhardt has now taken over in first. Morgan Shepherd is second. Waltrip has come to third. Maintaining fourth is the Neil Bonnet team. And in fifth is Kaylee Yarborough with six, Ricky Rudd. And all of those are stop contenders. Back comes Bodine. Seventh position for Jeff Bodine. Then in eighth is Buddy Baker. Ninth is Harry Gant. And tenth is Richard Petty.
Earnhardt, his car not exactly right, because with those new tires, he should be able to pull away from the Morgan Shepherd Pontiac. He can't do it. Morgan hanging right in there, and it looks like Morgan, each corner, is looking inside Earnhardt, trying to take the lead back. And the guy that's coming, Darrell Waltrip.
Indeed, Darrell Waltrip lying just two car lengths back from this pair, number three and number 75, Earnhardt and Shepherd, respectively. There's number 11. And as you look at the interval, hey, that's not much at all. Here's Earnhardt taking that wide line. Morgan Shepherd tucking down to the bottom of the racetrack. Pressure stays right on those leaders all afternoon, Benny. Just hasn't been any let-up. Whoever has led, with the exception of a few laps where Tim Richmond had it all his own way, it has been nip and tuck for that lead.
It has been nip and tuck. And the one thing that happened is, we haven't talked about it, but Tim Richmond being in the pits, even for the few laps that he's been in there. And as Chris Economaki said, there's going to be even more laps. Morgan Shepherd is alongside Earnhardt as he come off turn four. What I was going to say is that Tim Richmond's championship hope just went down the drain when he had to go in and make that unscheduled pit stop.
It's over for him as far as the title, but he's still trying to hold on to third here. And there's a great battle from fourth back to tenth in the standings. We'll try to get to that a bit later. Now there's Earnhardt fending off Morgan Shepherd another time. And these two drivers are really cut from the same cloth. They came out of a lot of short track experience, and they don't mind on a mile track doing a little leaning if they have to.
Not if that's what it takes to get by and win the race. Don't mind one bit. And Mr. Gentleman, Darrell Waltrip right behind him.
Yeah, Mr. Gentleman can take off the mask once in a while, too.
He's been on a few short tracks himself.
Cale Yarborough is still fourth. Ricky Rudd is in sixth. Bonnet is having a great day. He's in that fifth position. As we mentioned earlier, Buddy Baker. Again, Baker's team is coming together. It's his own team, and that's got to be hard, being your own driver and running your own outfit, but he's doing well with it.
I don't know who that was with the had some racing goggles on, but it didn't look like a racer.
Looked like a racer to me. Strong enthusiast there.
Doug Reichert, I think, is the new crew chief on the Buddy Baker Oldsmobile, and I think Doug is going to help because he brings expertise, several years of expertise, and from different teams. He worked with Junior Johnson for a couple of years, and he brings some of that to the Baker.
Okay. Uh-oh. Look out. Here it comes. Here goes Morgan Shepherd high. Here comes Waltrip low. Waltrip is closing in on that number 75. It's car 75 in second place. And right underneath, here comes Waltrip again. He seems to be getting a handle on the bottom of the racetrack. And he was diving lower. Now he's come out, run that same line. Three cars running for the lead. Earnhardt is there. Then it's Shepherd in second. Waltrip maintaining third. They're averaging 135.6 miles per hour while they dodge and dart through heavy traffic on this 1 mile North Carolina Motor Speedway. We'll be back with more of the action of the Nationwise American 500 after these messages.
We're back at the STP Pit Communication Center in Rockingham, North Carolina. Nationwise 500 action. Great battle at the front. Earnhardt and Shepherd. A little later, we'll show you Shepherd's amazing victory here yesterday. The title contenders, Earnhardt and Waltrip, are close. These three guys have all won races this year. The old veteran, Cale Yarborough, hasn't won one yet. He's back there in fourth. And, Ken, it looks to me like that battle is tightening up.
The whole front of the field is tightening up. Here you see the two leaders. There are the two front runners. That is Earnhardt in first, and running right behind him, Morgan Shepherd in second. And then there's a fair interval back to third place, which at the moment, there it is, that's Waltrip, and closing in is Cale Yarborough in fourth. Gives you a pretty good perspective.
Waltrip gets high, very, very high, can almost lost the car coming off turn
something
four.
Something's amiss, too, because here comes Cale. It looked for me like for just a moment, Waltrip may have stepped off it. He's high again. Do you think that... something is amiss on his handling. He's using up a lot more track than he was. He tail's getting right down to the bottom.
He is getting to the bottom of the racetrack. Well, a few moments ago, Darrell Walter was right up on the back bumper of Morgan Shepherd. He's not been able to stay there. And Morgan Shepherd, we watched Cale and Darrell come off the corner side by side.
I'll tell you one other thing to watch, Ben. Take a look at 28. I think it looks like there's a piece of paper that is now stuck up on the radiator of car number 28 on Cale's car. And he may begin to see some strange readings on the old temperature gauge here.
He certainly can, particularly when he gets up behind Darrell Walters and blocks some of the air going through the grill. Yes, I did see that piece of paper as he came by the last time, and that is a, could be a serious problem.
There it is.
There was it right directly in the middle of the grill.
That doesn't help matters a bit.
And out blocks almost all the grill. So if Cale Yarborough was had any, if his water temperature was anywhere near the limit, he could have serious problems with that piece of paper on the grill.
190-lap rundown upcoming. Again, the distance today to halfway is 246 laps. 492 to make the distance today. And here is Walter holding on to that position. And notice that Bodine, meanwhile, up in front, it's getting serious for the lead. The leaders begin to lean on each other here. Morgan Shepherd and Earnhardt beginning to fight it out. There they are, coming off the corner. Morgan Shepherd gets back up, makes a good run on Earnhardt, and he's back into first place.
Morgan.
As we watch this lead battle, Morgan Shepherd definitely came here to race. Waltrip behind him. Fascinating situation with that car. He's chasing those two leaders. It looked like he had a problem as he started to drop back into the pack. And now we see that the 75 cars are going to pull away a little bit. Morgan Shepherd's put about 4 or 5 car lengths on Dale Earnhardt. I think there's an interesting story on that Waltrip situation. We'll try to get back to it as we watch this lead battle.
Lead battle begins to separate for a moment. Morgan Shepherd seems to have found the handle, Benny. He just waltzes back up in there again.
Morgan Shepherd is driving his heart out. He hasn't found a handle. He's just trying his best to make it up with sheer ability. The car is loose. It's slipping and sliding, but he is driving as hard as he possibly can.
Well, just behind these two, I guess I was flat wrong on Walter. He's using that high line, and now he's drawing away from Cale. In two laps, he totally changed what he was doing. Started to run on the high side. He must have found something up there he liked. He continues to run up there, and he's leaving Cale. Well, he hasn't really left him. Cale's right there within 4 or 5 car lengths.
Jeff Bodine, the outside pole sitter, coming down pit road one more time. Another unscheduled stop for Bodine as we're watching Darrell Waltrip and Cale Yarborough continue their battle for third spot.
Fifth place Bodine comes in. That'll move Ricky Rudd up into 6th and move Buddy Baker into 7th. I believe right now that those four Thunderbirds are really playing waiting. Just waiting. And there's
cars running hot. Cars running hot. They have that water they're squirting in the grill, into the radiator, trying to cool the thing off.
Now, although the sun makes it look like it is a red hot day, notice the sweater on Gary Nelson there. That tells the story. The temperature's in the bottom end of the 60s here at Rockingham this afternoon. Isn't that warm on the racetrack compared to a Talladega in August or Charlotte back in May?
As we watch them cool off that car, we keep in mind that that was one of the hottest cars here, not only in qualifying when Bodine sat on the outside of the front row, but perhaps even more importantly, yesterday in the final practice session. That's when they really dial these babies in, and you see who's got the speed. It was no surprise that Richmond and Bodine, the two front row starters, maintained their speed through that practice. But one guy we've mentioned in passing a couple of times, and we'll see more of today, I think, is Neil Bonnet, who has been up close to the front after fading back to the back after the immediate start of the race. He charged back up. He got into contention. He was the third car who ran very fast yesterday in the final session. This guy ran fast yesterday in the Grand National race. Bob Barsh is going to show us that event in the GM Goodrich Racing update coming up in just a moment. Morgan Shepherd clobbered him yesterday, and now he's leading it again here today.
Coming up toward 200 laps complete within a couple of laps as Shepherd continues to draw a bead on a checkered flag. Long way to go, though. Long way to go. Now look at Morgan using up that racetrack. All the way from the bottom, all the way to the top, being just as easy on that race car as he can possibly be, and still flat foot the thing.
You know, it looks to me like that Morgan found that groove almost by mistake. He was running on the bottom of the racetrack just a few laps ago. He got in some traffic and had to move up on the racetrack. Cale Yarborough smoking badly coming off turn 4. He's down on the inside. He's off the throttle.
Cale Yarborough coming out, and I don't think it's going to bring a caution as he comes down onto the first turn apron. That's the the end of Cale today, and as he drops out, if Cale goes away, that's going to move Waltrip third, Bonnet fourth, Rudd fifth, Baker to sixth, Richard Petty up to seventh, Gant to eighth, and I believe those are the cars now in the lead lap.
I was starting to say a while ago that I think Morgan found the groove by mistake. He started to pass some cars, and as he did, he discovered how much he gained on Earnhardt. He said, whoops, I better try this a couple more laps. And sure enough, he got the high groove working and working well.
And it almost parallels the line that Darrell Waltrip has now found.
As a matter of fact, Darrell said, hey, he's making some progress up there. Let me try it. Darrell Waltrip went up there, and he's holding his own.
201 laps complete. There is no caution here.
The piece of paper that we see on the grill.
That's the story.
That was the downfall of Cale Yarborough. The car got too hot, and the engine let go.
Here's Chris. Chris still talking to one of the officials there on that car. Chris?
Yes, we're down here at Cale Yarborough. The engine has been missing. The paper has not been a serious problem. It's an ignition problem, and it looks like they've got five ignition specialists under the hood right now. And Cale patiently waits while a man is inside the car, makes the chassis adjustments. It appears as though they don't know specifically what the problem is. Back to you.
So that's the end of the day for the Knuckles team. Waddell Wilson used to be the name. A new young man takes over on that organization for Harry Rainier, A.T. Lundy, and the problem is terminal. Cale Yarborough is out of it.
That's the guy you picked to win the race. They're pushing back toward the garage here.
Nobody's perfect.
But I tell you what, he was very impressive in his last run with the Rainier Lundy team.
Wasn't it you that told me impressive doesn't count, only wins?
Only wins. There we see Joe Rutman's car. The picture from inside Joe Rutman's car.
He's up to 15th. Lap down, maybe two laps down now after he was brought in by the officials for taking another interesting line to the start.
On the restart, he's supposed to wait until they drop the green flag.
He was eager to try to see what he could do about getting some spots back. Just puts a lap on Kenny Schrader in number 90. Rutman, 15th. There you see him coming down the main straightaway. Kenny Bernstein's Quaker State team. New driver on the car for next year.
Is Morgan Shepherd, the fellow who's leading the race right now.
That could be a pretty strong combination. Bodine is in another time. Jeff Bodine back on pit road.
When Bodine went back on the racetrack a moment ago, he never did get up to speed. He ran around the racetrack a few laps, but at a slow speed. Here is another shot from inside the Joe Rutman automobile. That's Kenny Schrader, the Red Baron Ford behind him.
And there you see this lovely crowd, and also you get a great idea about what a great day we have here. I mean, it's a magnificent day. Just picture perfect. A Morgan Shepherd could do exactly what Earnhardt did just 2 weeks ago. Win on Saturday, win on Sunday. Here he is out in front, and wouldn't it be great for him? Kent Brown and Company are the sponsors of this, the Nationwise folks, and he could have the car. Let's go down to Chris Economak. To Jerry Garrett.
Okay, we're down here with Cale Yarborough. What put you out, Cale?
I don't know. Something went wrong in the engine. It started missing, and then it finally let go. Something broke in the engine.
We noticed a big piece of paper on the front grill for a while. Could that have done it?
I don't think I did it. I was watching the temperature, and it never got real hot, so something just broke.
Tough one, and there's a tough one for Bodine as well. Well, this is a track of hard knocks, and it's been that way for years. But so far, we've been blessed with any of those serious multi-car calamities, which have been the order of the day. In fact, Benny Parsons can attest to just how rigorous this track is. In 1973, when he was going for the championship, he was nearly eliminated right here in turn number two. Now, there's a battle for fourth going on as Neil Bonnet begins to feel some pressure from Ricky Rudd. Well, they come rocketing off the corner. That's Eddie Bierschwald down on the inside in car 17.
Rudd trying to look inside the Neil Bonnet car coming off turn four with those slow cars. Eddie Bierschwald and the Mike Skinner automobile is in front of them.
The Bonnet car in. He's moving on to a new team. He'll be with the Raymock Racing. That's the team that's out in front for the moment here.
Yeah, folks, you're going to have to buy a program next spring to tell who's and what.
Yeah, the Daytona 500 could get real interesting.
Sure could.
Here's Chris.
Okay, we're down here in Tim Richmond's pit, and we're looking at the axle of that overheated so much that it broke. It's still so hot, you can't pick it up with your bare hands. And what they will replace it with is a full unit here. They're still working on it. You can see about 8 or 10 men working on the car here, trying to get the old one out. They just never say die in stock car racing. Back to you.
That's the story on Tim Richmond. As his hopes fade for getting a crack at Earnhardt or Walter in the Winston Cup standings with two races to go. And of course, we'll be with you for the grand finale at Riverside, California, here on the Superstation WTBS. Back straight away, watching the action. Great crowd here, watching Morgan Shepherd have just a dandy day. Can he keep it up? We'll find out.
Back here live at North Carolina Motor Speedway, where the Nationwise Rocking M500 continues, and you're looking at Jeff Bodine, one of our front row starters, is out of it now. Jeff, we'll put you out.
We think we either cracked the cylinder head, blew head gasket, a number of things could happen. We're losing water out the exhaust pipe. Now, you can't keep enough water into it to keep going. We'd like to be out there riding around getting some more points, but we can't do it. It's got that big a hole. We need a real big cork to plug it up.
Well, that's going to hurt him in the points. He's one of those guys that's in that fourth through ninth position where there's about $150,000 at stake.
Well, here you see Tim Richmond coming back out again as he tries to stay out of fourth and up in third position standing. They've made the repairs, and he is back out to try it once again. He's 48 laps down, but back on the track. And of the three people that started up in front, they have all been encumbered by difficulties today. Richmond is able to come back, but Kale is out and Bodine is out. And it looks like it's almost a hex today to start it up in front of this field.
Ricky Rudd, the fourth starter, is still on the racetrack, and Darrell Waltrip, the fifth starter, is still on the racetrack. Darrell Waltrip right now looking good at third spot, and Rudd in fifth.
The race trundles on toward the 220 lap mark with Morgan Shepherd continuing to be an outstanding performer. There's Bobby Wowak. They say he has a bad tire on car number 74. Gosh, I can remember in the days when he could qualify 20th, 25th. They have a bearing that's beginning to bother that car a little bit. Wowak looks like he's having a wild ride, and I'm surprised they haven't brought him in.
I am too. I'm surprised he doesn't go in, because we watched Tim Richmond just a moment ago. There we see the smoke coming in the back of the car. We watched Tim Richmond just a moment ago, and he almost spun coming off the second corner. And anytime you get the car sideways on a racetrack like this, at the speeds they're traveling, you've got problems.
Here he is. Moving forward, but I'd say he's riding on a tightrope that could snap at any moment. Morgan Shepherd stays up in front. Just a great roller skater. His favorite thing in the whole world besides racing is roller skating. And now, he's darn good at it.
He is good at it. And Morgan Shepherd now has moved back down on the bottom of the racetrack. Now he's going to the top of the racetrack, go through three and four. I just noticed he was on the bottom of the racetrack. I don't know what he's trying to do. He's just trying different blinds, different grooves around the racetrack. And I'm sure the crew is telling him which is the fastest way. And he right now is doing a lot of experimenting, trying to find the absolute best way around this racetrack.
Having a high old time, Morgan Shepherd. Here's Dave Despain.
Down here at the STP Pit Communication Center, we continue to watch the progress of the big stars of today in Winston Cup stock car racing. Shepherd, Earnhardt, Waltrip, Bonnet, all the superstars. Out there on the racetrack, a couple of upcoming youngsters are having themselves a battle for Rookie of the Year, and this is Alan Kulwicki in car number 35. He's currently running 13th out there on the track, but Kulwicki's a big story here this weekend. He qualified 21st. Let's say he started 21st, because he actually qualified a little faster than that. He did not qualify on the first day when the 20 positions are locked in. He was actually the 12th fastest car in the field at 142 miles an hour, and Kulwicki out there stomping around right now in 13th spot has his rival for the championship, not necessarily on the ropes for Rookie of the Year, but at least behind him for today and behind him in the standings. And that challenger, ironically, is Darrell Waltrip's little brother Mike. Kulwicki is 13th, and Mike Waltrip is three positions back in 16th. Alan Kulwicki, a graduate of the Midwestern short track ranks, might have his name right up here on our STP leaderboard in the very near future.
Kulwicki's been an amazing story. The first part of the season was all learning. Every track he's come back to, As he laps Bobby Wolak, he has run really well in that Ford Thunderbird. He only has two mechanics. He has one car and a couple of engines. He has a friend that loans him cars for Super Speedway. And this is the young man that qualified seventh at Charlotte against the very best in the world just 2 weeks ago. And he came out 12th overall in the standings, as Dave pointed out. As far as speed was concerned in getting in here, and we didn't think there was too much sense in following him on the start because he wasn't going to do anything serious. He wasn't going to make any dramatic moves. He's going to run this race out. Hope a lot of folks see him, get to remember him. I like him. He carries a briefcase. Everywhere he goes, he's ready to do business.
Well, that's where racing is going in the next few years, and that's the people who carry briefcases, not wrenches. I told someone just not too long ago that I feel like there we see Morgan Shepherd, the leader, as he continues down the, I think that's the back straightaway, going in turn three.
We've got a car pity on Labonte, maybe bringing number 44, and it's been an off again afternoon for Labonte, and the 10th place runner comes down into the pits very slowly. Our attrition rates continuing to develop here in this track of hard knocks. Terry Labonte is going behind the wall and back to the garage area, and right behind him comes Dick Trickle's car number 42. Now, Trickle is the great Midwestern runner. He's on pit road. The old Bill's Barbecue. I told you, he gets sponsors everywhere you can. And there's Dick Trickle, the great Midwest champion out of Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin, who had been running 16th on the field. And he's in for right side rubber, ready to bring it on. They're going to go all the way around, four tires on Dick Trickle.
This may be a scheduled stop. Dick Trickle may not have stopped on one of the caution flags just a few moments ago, and this may be a normal pit stop.
He's one of the raciest guys in the country. He cut his schedule back. He used to run 110 races a year. This year he cut it back. He thought it was too much. He's only going to run 80 times. He told me, he said, I'm having a terrible season. I haven't won a race. No, I don't mean that. He said, I haven't won a race in the ASA. I think I've won 15 or 20 somewhere else. Dick Trickle back underway. And out in front, there you see 75, Morgan Shepherd's car, continuing to be the star of the field.
Morgan Shepherd. Yesterday, he won a 200-mile race here with a sportsman car, and he used the low part of the track, the middle part of the track, and the high part of the track. It seems to be his style. And the question I have for Benny Parsons is the fact that he went 200 miles on this track yesterday and won a plus for today.
I don't know if it is or not, Chris. I would not think so because of the difference in the weight of the cars. These cars, the cars we're looking at right now, are 3,700 pounds. The automobile that Morgan used yesterday was about 3,100 pounds. And the 600 pounds, I think, would make enough difference. He really couldn't use what he learned yesterday.
Well, you see, Wolak's car is still out there, and it's still smoldering up there on that right front tire. And the car number 75 continues to be the leader. There's that Wolak car right behind him. Here's Jerry Garrett.
We're down here with Terry Labonte, who's out of the race. Now, Terry usually runs real strong here. He never seemed to be in it today.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear a word you said. I don't know what happened to the car. The engine just quit.
You seem to run strong here, but today you just weren't in it.
No, we hadn't been close all week long. I really don't know what the problem was. The car seemed to be working pretty well in the race. We got a lap down early and, you know, never were able to make it back up. And then it seemed like we lost a little power and something let go in the engine.
Keep in mind one thing about Terry Labonte. He's going to join that number 12 team, the team that now runs number 12. That was Neil Bonnet. This is Morgan Shepherd. I got one footnote to his story. The last time he won a Winston Cup race was down in Atlanta. You know what was similar? He went out and killed him on Saturday in that race, too. He ran the Grand National on Saturday, went out and whooped him, and came back and made it a double weekend that weekend, too. So this guy may have something going for him here this afternoon.
Morgan Shepherd, still the class of the field. Dale Earnhardt maintaining the second position. Shepherd has a good, healthy advantage over Dale Earnhardt. The point to be made here is that the more cars that fall out of the race, the better Earnhardt's championship aspirations become.
That's exactly right, because every time a car goes behind the wall, that's another 3 points that Earnhardt picks up. If he should have a problem right now, he just gained 3 points by Terry Labonte having his problem.
One more caution, he'd be back up. We're toward the halfway point here at Rockingham this afternoon, and there he is, the kick out the walls, man.
The leader is on pit road.
We're getting up toward regularly scheduled stops, and there is Morgan Shepherd coming in. A couple of tire marks on the left side of the car. Jackman goes to work, right side rubber.
This is a normal pit stop because Morgan Shepherd did not pit on the last caution flag. The other cars, the three car of Dale Earnhardt, will be able to run just a few more laps than Morgan Shepherd.
Bobby Hillen is pitting about the same time. As 75 pulls out, there's Hillen in. Earnhardt has taken the lead. Waltrip to second. Pit stop by Shepherd with 17 seconds, and there's the winner of the Talladega 500, young Bobby Hillen out of Midland, Texas. His dad and grandpa watching today. They've had some great teams of Unser and company over the years. And we're back with Joe Ruttman, 14th position, giving you his perspective on the rock. More in a moment. Dale Earnhardt has just pitted, giving the lead to Darrell Waltrip. Give Waltrip 5 points. First time he has led this afternoon in his effort to overcome Earnhardt. From Joe Ruttman's car, you see the leader here as he throttles into the banking another time. Waltrip is in first. Bonnet is in second. Ricky Rudd is third. Buddy Baker is in fourth. Let's get some updates from the pit side now.
Well, it's said that baseball is a sport where strategy is paramount. But there's strategy in stock car racing, too. And when Morgan Shepherd passed up the last yellow flag and didn't stop, and had to stop now to get on gas and tires and lose the lead, this could very well be the big mistake for Morgan Shepherd in Rockingham today. Now let's go down to Jerry Garrett.
Well, Dale Earnhardt was just in here a couple of moments ago, Chris, to make his scheduled pit stop. He took on two right side tires, two cans of fuel, no chassis change, back out in under 17 seconds.
Updating the leaderboard for you. Waltrip first, Bonnet second, Rudd third, Buddy Baker up to fourth, Richard Petty maintaining fifth. Rusty Wallace is back on pit road. Harry Gant is in sixth. Morgan Shepherd is in seventh. Here's your leader, car number 11, Waltrip, down another time out of turn number four.
Waltrip getting very good gas mileage. I was surprised how quickly that Dale Earnhardt pitted just a moment ago, and I felt like that Darrell Waltrip wouldn't be too far behind him, but no, Darrell's still going around the racetrack.
Moving toward the midway point of the race. About 245 laps complete. I think we're down toward the halfway mark right here. And as we get to it, there's the halfway signal out, and we are halfway in the distance with Waltrip in the lead. Here's Jerry Garrett.
Following up on what you said there about Earnhardt, he's only getting about 92, 95 laps on a tank of gas. The first two sessions, and he had to go that long. That's what he's got. Waltrip, he's been able to get over 100.
Leader, Waltrip, fat advantage. Should be pitting soon. We'll report to the pits as to when they expect Darrell Waltrip to come in. Beginning to put together our Valvoline report, our resume on the first half of this break. $400,000, 500-mile contest.
The advantage that Morgan Shepherd and Dale Earnhardt got when they made their pit stop a moment ago, they did not lose a lap to the leader. There's Jeff Hammond, Walter's crew chief, going over talking to Junior Johnson, deciding exactly what they're going to do and when they're going to do it.
Kyle Petty is pitted.
Here's Ricky Rudd, coming, the third-place car coming down pit road.
Rudd is in. But Moore and company have really put together an outstanding day for Ricky Rudd. Car gets jacked in the air. Earnhardt is in for 14 and a half seconds. Clock ticking away on Ricky Rudd. Third place when he pitted. Pit stops under green. Eight cars running the lead lap. Gant on the tail end, who had been an eighth, but picked up a couple of spots to six. 15 and 2/10 seconds. Some enthusiasts out here this afternoon. Here's the Elliott car in. And remember that he's running back out of the lead lap, shown in ninth position.
They're changing left sides on Bill Elliott's car. A switch. All the rest of the car. And Darrell Waltrip, the leader, coming down pit road.
Waltrip in number 11 whistles down through there. Gets on the binders. Hammond, Johnson, company, ready. Here's Chris.
Darrell Waltrip continues to complete 97 laps on this tank of fuel, and a man is in the car again making an adjustment. So his car is quite the way he likes it. Very fast up, and he got away before all of the fuel got in, it appears to be. He didn't go 100 laps, as they said the Chevrolet should go. Supposedly 105 is the maximum. He only went 97 on that tank full. Back to you.
Second place man, Neil Bonnet, also in. That's interesting on Waltrip stop. Buddy Baker, who is having a magnificent day. Here he is coming out of pit road. Baker's still trying to win this race for the first time. He's been trying since 1965, and this is one that's eluded him. 19-time winner, Baker. Right side rubber for Baker.
Then we see Dirk Rocker changing the right side of that car. Darrell Walters got a little bit better gas mileage than Dale Earnhardt, and that may be a factor before this day is over. Good stop for Buddy Baker. Down, he's away. Here comes Harry Gantz, Cole Bennett down pit road. Travis Carter, the crew, they're ready for Harry.
He had come all the way up to second place with all these pit stops. This car, number 33, was almost ready to collect 5 points and had to come in. Don't want to run them too lean in the fuel department.
No, that's exactly right, because when you run out of fuel, exactly right, you lean a piston and you burn a piston before you can even back off the throttle. So you've got to play it real close, but keep fueling it at all times.
Meanwhile, Petty's coming in. Richard Petty, number 43, brings the STP colors down pit road. Still looking for victory number 201. Long time for Petty since July 4th, a couple of years back. He took that 200th win. All of these stops coming under green flag conditions may separate this race considerably. To give
You're
over
exactly
the race.
Right. You know, the first three cars, the Morgan Shepherd, as we watch Richard Petty.
Richard Petty was the leader of this race, by the way, when he came in. The cars that had stopped in front of him, of course, were ahead of him until they had to make their stops. He was last to stop in the group. But the point I think that's important is that here on his home track, he lives just down the road, Richard Petty is very much in the hunt here this afternoon. And as the attrition continues up front, don't count the old guy out.
He was trying to get a lap on Mike Waltrip.
Richard Petty right now is a lap down. That's Morgan Shepherd, the leader, right directly in front of Richard Petty. That car right in front of him is Morgan Shepherd, the leader. Richard Petty a lap down. He needs to get by Morgan Shepherd if he possibly can. Then if a caution flag were to come out, he'd be able to go all the way around and make up a complete lap on the leader. And look, he comes off. He's alongside Morgan going down the back straightaway. He's going to try to get it in turn three.
Remember that Shepherd is running slightly out of sync with the rest of the field and he stops. He was the first car in. He made a stop earlier in this race to put him just a little out of sync for the rest of the field. How that will play out, we'll have to wait and see.
Well, Ken, you make that point about Shepherd's pit stop at risk of quarreling with our sage, Chris Economaki. I'd like to make a further point about that. He's not very far out of sync. He passed up that early yellow, as Chris noted, stayed on the racetrack, and that put him right up at the front of the pack. But I think even more important, perhaps, for the long-term duration of the race, keeping in mind that we're just at halfway, so fuel for the run to the finish isn't an issue yet. They'll have a lot more pit stops, undoubtedly a couple of more yellows. I think the key point is this. The first... What? Third of the race, I guess, was a little dirty. We had 3, 4, 5 yellow flags. Everybody was shuffling it out of the pit. Then we went out and made a real long green flag run when we really found out what the cars could do. And that was when Morgan Shepherd went to the front, passed Dale Earnhardt, took the lead, and dominated. Yeah, he's 4 and 5 laps off on his pit stop sequence, but I don't think that's going to hurt him. I think he's got a very strong race car.
All right, Judge Parsons, what do you think?
I think right now that Darrell Waltrip has the best car on the racetrack. Morgan Shepherd got out of the pits in front. He still is leading the race, but the three car, Dale Earnhardt, been able to gain quite a few seconds on in the last 10 or 15 laps, and Darrell Waltrip, who is third place, has gained even on Earnhardt. So Darrell Waltrip getting closer and closer to the front. Morgan Shepherd just can't find the line he had just a few moments ago. He's searching and searching. He can't find the fast way around the racetrack.
Now, after this sort out, after all of these stops under green flag conditions, Morgan Shepherd has reappropriated first place. Dale Earnhardt's in second. Darrell Waltrip's in third. Neil Bonnet in fourth. Ricky Rudd is shown fifth. Gant is in sixth. Baker is in seventh. And Richard Petty in number 43 is in eighth.
You see, Richard Petty passed Morgan Shepherd and just drove away. So that means that Morgan's car certainly isn't as good as it was a few moments ago. And Earnhardt, meanwhile, getting closer and closer. And there's Darrell Waltrip in third. He's even getting closer to Earnhardt. So we're going to have a race for the lead coming up shortly that's going to be a barn burner.
Interesting to note that Petty, who's been waiting a while and just hasn't come off for him, right now is running as fast as anyone on this racetrack.
That's right. Richard Petty right now is the quickest car on the speedway. But he is almost a lap down.
Benny, let's get together our halftime report and see how we are at the mid-race of this Rockingham American Nationwise 500. We'll be back to take a look at what's happened over the first half of the race. Follow the action after this. 146 laps complete. We've reached the halfway mark. And it's time to take a look at our Valvoline reprieve on the first half of this Nationwise American 500 here at the North Carolina Motor Speedway in Rockingham. Waltrip currently in front at the halfway point. Neil Bonnet, his teammate, in second. There's Ricky Rudd doing a great job in third. Baker and Petty representing the old-timers in fourth and fifth. Looking further back in the field here this afternoon, Harry Gant stays sixth, Morgan Shepherd seventh, Earnhardt after that pit stop in eighth, eight cars in the lead lap. Bill Elliott's running the lap down, and Bobby Hillen stays tenth. Hillen gets better every race he runs. Further back, Rusty Wallace is in 11th, Alan Kowicki is in 12th, and there's Kyle Petty. Joe Ruttman sustaining in 14th position, carrying our onboard camera in the Quaker State car. There have been 13 lead changes among seven drivers today, five cautions for 24 laps. Now, usually in this race, we have a lot of momentous moments with cars spinning, colliding, getting collected off these corners. That has not been the case today, but there have been incidents. Let's take a look at the moments that have been recorded thus far. Back straightaway, turn number two is where the action always is, and today has been absolutely no exception. Jeff Bodine, who qualified on the outside of the front row, having trouble here spinning, and it began his problems, which terminated just a little while ago. Tim Richmond had led the first 61 laps, and then he had trouble, and he made a tremendous save in the same place that his teammate had spun, was able to bring the car in. After 48 laps, he continues. The real story of this race has been Earnhardt's efforts, which have been so smooth, and the big surprise has been Morgan Shepherd, who has gone out and dominated after the past 40 or 50 laps. Now, how do you see it?
I think you're exactly right. Morgan Shepherd is the story of the race, Ken, because here's a fellow you didn't pick, I didn't pick, I don't think anyone here picked him to win the race, but yet he's out in front right now halfway.
A dominating force. Morgan Shepherd staying very much in this race, now leading, but Dale Earnhardt is closing as well as Darrell Waltrip. Let's go back to the action here. There you see Morgan in car number 75 staying up in that front-running spot. But the handle that was working so beautifully a little while ago, he could just twitch its tail and take it where he wanted to, seems not to be as stout as it was. Earnhardt has been closing in, no question about that. And Waltrip continues to look stronger as this race goes on. But for my money, the guy who looks as good as anybody out here is Ricky Rudd. What a dandy day he's having. He's staying out of trouble. He's watching all these guys run, and he is not being the hare. He's been the hound all afternoon just waiting till they get freed.
So you're saying at halfway point you're picking Ricky Rudd now to win.
Oh, I can't make another choice. I went with Cale, and like
you said,
I wasn't right.
We'll let you have another one at halfway.
All right. At halfway.
Who are you going to pick to win the race now?
Well, I think I'll go with Ricky Rudd.
There he is on the screen, and he's looking good.
There's nothing like having a half race reprieve.
I'm going to take Morgan Shepherd because he really is running well. And Harry Gant gets the car sideways up in the corner. But meanwhile, that's Ricky Rudd going down in turn one. And you're right, a great job for Ricky Rudd through the first 270 laps.
Say, it's hard to go against Morgan Shepherd the way he ran yesterday. And he is so knowledgeable on these tracks. He's just a good racer.
Well, okay, Ken, you pick Ricky Rudd, and Benny likes Morgan Shepherd, but I'll tell you what, the guy I'm looking at right now is the guy who's got the most to gain by winning this automobile race here this afternoon, and that's Dale Earnhardt, because if he wins it, nobody's going to catch him in this championship, and you know who's catching on the racetrack? He's catching Morgan Shepherd. Strong car, strong driver, determined, cool, loose. Look here, he's right on Shepherd's bumper. He's running down. Yeah, I said 5 minutes ago I thought Morgan had a strong race car, and I still think that, but I think the guy who's got the most to win here today is Dale Earnhardt. He wants to put that championship out of Darrell Waltrip's reach. He's had Darrell behind him all day long. Earnhardt wants that title bad. It's been a long time since 1980 when he won the last one. And if we're going to play this mid-race game, what? I got it. I want in on it. There goes Earnhardt trying to take the lead, and he's my pick to win it.
Well, you picked him in Richmond a couple of years ago and hit it right on the head, and you may have it again. Here he is underneath Morgan Shepherd and going back out in front. Dale Earnhardt, the 1979 Rookie of the Year, and came back for Rod Austin and Company to win the title in 1980. And here he is. He does a great counter psych job on Waltrip. He says, you know, Waltrip has always been upset because I won the championship before he did, and it really bothers him.
Dale Earnhardt has handled Darrell Waltrip's humor as well as anyone in the world. And believe me, Darrell Walton's humor is something strange.
At Charlotte, North Carolina, Earnhardt was magnificent. After he had a great day, he would stir the press up a little and then go back in his truck and ask people going by, what is Darrell saying? Has he heard what I said this time? He loves to race, and he loves the taste of being a champion. Earnhardt at number three, leading Morgan Shepherd.
Now the thing that Morgan Shepherd has got to do is he just got to be content the fact that Earnhardt has passed him. Don't do anything crazy because there's still a long way to go, Morgan. You're going to make two more pit stops, probably three, before this day is over. So just hang in there. Follow Earnhardt. See where he's going. Maybe you find a groove that'll get your car around the racetrack a little bit faster.
Remember, we mentioned earlier that there's a tremendous battle going on from fourth back through 10th in the Winston standings. And indeed, that is the case. Ricky Rudd is in fourth, just 25 points in front of Bill Elliott. And Elliott only has 39 points on Wallace, and Wallace has only 8 points on Bodine. That is some tremendous scramble. And the money back there, fourth place is worth $115,000. Fifth drops down to some $85,000. Ricky Rudd trying to hold off a number of drivers, trying to knock him out of that $115,000 fourth place
prize. $150,000 at the end of the year, so it's important to us to try to stay up in the points just as well as it is for the guys, Earnhardt and Walter, trying to go for the win. So we're having our own little battle back here, but I wish it was for first and second instead of for fourth.
He still could be around to be first in this race, averaging 134 miles an hour. On this mile-plus track, just a little over a mile, Ricky Rudd, here he is, down the back straightaway, getting a lap on the number 64 of Mike Potter out of Johnson City, Tennessee, the Bullfrog Mitsford.
That car was going to be driven by Buddy Baker's son, Brian Baker, the Ford 64 that Ricky Rudd just went by. But Buddy said Brian better not drive because he doesn't have enough experience. He don't want him to be the problem, Earnhardt or Walter's problem, going to this championship.
Rudd lies fourth in car number 15. Up in front, Morgan Shepherd has a mirror full of Dale Earnhardt has a mirror full of Morgan Shepherd as they continue to circulate around this oval. How do you feel about this way, halfway in this race, and you know you've got so long to go? Usually 500-mile race, Daytona, Talladega. It's over by now.
It's over by now, and that's the problem. That's the one thing that I was trying to tell Morgan Shepherd a moment ago. I'm sure he wasn't listening because he was busy. But it is a long ways. It is still another 2 hours before this thing is going to be decided. So take it easy. Watch the lines. Figure out how you're going to be able to do it a couple hours from now.
Amazing the stamina of these drivers as they continue to battle this track and each other for supremacy in the $400,000 Nationwise American 500. More in a moment.
Rockingham, 65. Now that was a goodie. Bristol, 74. That was another goodie. Daytona, 82. That was definitely a goodie. I've won over 200 races, but I've had over 700 headaches. So just take it from me. Goodies gets rid of the pain fast, and that's what counts.
Goodies headache powders and extra.
Dale Earnhardt out in front. He came here just a day or so after he won at Charlotte, North Carolina, started to work this car out, and it looks like he has found the combination. For the moment, he's running up in front of Morgan Shepherd in second place. They've completed better than 280 laps of the 496 to be run. Shepherd's in second, Waltrip's in third, Neil Bonnet is in fourth, Ricky Rudd holds on to fifth, Harry Gant in sixth, Baker in seventh, Petty in eighth, those eight in the lead lap. Let's go to Bob Barsha. He's standing by with a GM Goodwrench update on other racing going on around America.
Thank you, Ken. The NASCAR Modified Stars will probably crown their 1986 champion today at Thompson, Connecticut. With just a couple of events left on the series, points runner-up Jamie Tomato has to win this afternoon at Thompson and hope that points leader Jimmy Spencer drops out of the race in order for Tomato to have a shot at it. Tomato will start third, Spencer sixth today at Thompson. Here at Rockingham yesterday, the son of stock car legend David Pearson didn't win the 200-miler for Grand National Cars, but he took a big step toward the first national championship of his own.
The story of the race was simply the dominating performance of number 77, Morgan Shepherd. Behind Shepherd, the battle was for championship points. Jack Ingram and number 11, back from a suspension that cost him the points lead, had to win. He raced 21, points leader Larry Pearson for third before blowing his engine. As a result, Ingram will not win his sixth title this year. Points runner-up Brett Bodine with a bright new orange paint job had tire trouble and finished fifth a lap down. Pearson battled pole sitter Davey Allison before fading to fourth, but Pearson was the big winner because the Hickory, North Carolina race was canceled this week and only the finale at Martinsville, Virginia remains. The checkered flag went to Morgan Shepherd, but Larry Pearson, who's finished 27 straight races, is the heavy favorite to claim his first title next Sunday.
In World Championship Rally action, Marco Alain of Finland has won the San Remo Rally in Italy, driving a Lancia. Alain needed to get that win in order to keep his World Championship title hopes alive. We'll have more results from the SEC runoffs at Road Atlanta and more in our next edition of the GM Goodrich Motor Week Illustrated Racing Update.
Watching Dale Earnhardt about to put a lap on Richard Petty, the eighth-place runner, as they go down the back straightaway. Petty was sideways, just two laps to go up here in turn three, and he seems to be off his speed. Coming around, car number three is going to lap the eighth-place car in the main straightaway. Perhaps this lap, perhaps not. Petty seems to be back on it. He stumbled.
He did stumble and stumbled badly. You're exactly right. It looked like he had a flat tire, but he filled it out for a couple of laps. And I don't think he has a flat tire, just the car got a little bit loose. He has decided to stay on the racetrack and take his chances.
Here's Earnhardt, again, trying to put a lap on Petty. Petty, a winner here on many occasions. Apparently not to be today. Here is Earnhardt. Logging that Richard Childress prepared car up the outside. Pace has come down that last lap at 133 miles per hour. We talk about grinding this race out. That's what it's coming to.
That's what it's coming to, and that's what Earnhardt is so good at. It's just he and Morgan Shepherd both, they're good at grinding it out.
Let me take you back in the field a little bit. This is your sixth place car, and I want you to watch here again. I hope he doesn't make a liar out of me here. I've had my eye on him for about 10 laps now. This is undoubtedly the most evil-handling race car I've had my eyes on in a while. He is all the way up by the fence. He can't keep the car out of the wall, and on every corner, it seems, he's been wiggling and wobbling around. Now, we talked about that Champion Spark Plug Racer of the Day Award. Keep in mind that Harry Gant had to make a pit stop. They pulled the shock absorber off the car. He went out and made another pit stop so they could put a new one on. The thing was handling horribly. They went through six sets of tires in the first, third of the race, and now he's got that old bandit out there. There aren't very many guys who can keep a car handling this badly out of the fence. I think if Harry Gant gets this one done without getting into the concrete, his name ought to go on the half for Champion Flex Club Racer of the Day. He's doing a good job.
Who else besides Gant can take an ill-handling car and make it work, Benny?
He does it as well as anyone. Morgan Shepherd is pretty good at that. Morgan Shepherd will go up to the top of the racetrack, use that green racetrack, that gray racetrack that we see up above the black mark, and make it handle as well as anyone.
Well, there's Morgan still in second place. Earnhardt up in front. Darrell Waltrip continues to lead. Now, this racetrack is historic. The first winner here was Curtis Turner. And all the great names of Winston Cup NASCAR racing have performed here. 20 years ago today, one of NASCAR's all-time giants, Ned Jarrett, hung up his helmet. Earlier, Dave Despain chatted with Ned about that historic day and his life of retirement and asked why he quit.
There were several reasons, Dave. One, I vowed to myself that however far up the ladder I got, I'd quit while I was there. I would never go down the other side. And when I did retire, there were a couple of races remaining. On the schedule in 1966, I was still the reigning champion, and that's the way that I wanted to go out. Now, I might have let my pride override my pocketbook by going in that concept. Another reason was that my children were growing up. Of course, we know that they're well grown up now, but I was not spending as much time with them as I wanted to. I had some second thoughts about it. As a matter of fact, the next year, I had a hard time staying away from the sport. I wanted to come back. It really was hard to go to races and not run. And then I got an opportunity to get in broadcasting, and that's the thing I think that helped to keep me from behind the wheel again. I found a new challenge, and honestly, it's a bigger challenge for me today than driving the race car was back then.
In what way?
I think the fact that I grew up on a farm, working at a sawmill, and then one day, to be sitting here talking to you and having done work at WTBS and CBS and Motor Racing Network, and now we have our own syndicated TV show, I think that's the challenge that is presented to me, having the background that I did, of which I'm very proud of, but still it's not the kind of a background that you normally think of for someone being in radio and television.
One last thing, Ned. It was exactly 20 years ago, right here at Rockingham,
You said your goodbyes to the fans, buckled into that race car for the final time, and had a really embarrassing moment.
I mentioned earlier that one of the reasons that I retired, that I didn't want to go down the other side, because people have a tendency to remember you for the last thing that you did. Well, they do. One of the last things that I did, I accidentally set the fire extinguisher off during the race. I had come in for a pit stop. They didn't get the windshield clean, and I reached down where the lever normally was that I would release the shoulder harness so I could lean out the window, and that wasn't the lever. It was the fire extinguisher instead, and it sprayed Purple K all over the car, inside and outside. I had to come in for a wash job on the car. I was running second at the time, finally finished third in the race. But that was an embarrassing moment for me. You know, that's the thing that people still remember most.
Named as the Grand Marshal, one of the great ambassadors of motorsport, Ned Jarrett, here at this Nationwise American 500. Dale Earnhardt continues out in front. Morgan Shepherd is in second. We just saw the number 25 car come back in. Remember, he's running considerably down. Richmond pitting for a moment. Let's get out of the pits and get an update. I think Jerry Garrett can fill us in.
Well, you're looking at a member of Harry Gant's crew who's been gluing lug nuts on new tires that they've purchased. So the Gant saga continues. It's been through 32 tires now. They went and bought 16 more from Goodyear. Just had them mounted. They're ready to go.
And what Dave Despain was talking about the ill-handling, ill-mannered car number 33, has certainly been proven out over the past five or six laps. Harry has used up a whole lot of racetrack as he touched the wall, but he's been locked to lock a couple of times to keep that car from getting into the concrete this afternoon. Richard Petty's car has also totally gone away.
It has gone away. Richard's still trying to run the bottom of the racetrack, but his car completely gone away. Earnhardt went by the 75 car Morgan Shepherd about 10 or 15 laps ago, but Morgan Shepherd's still hanging in. There's Darrell Waltrip. He's the third place car. Darrell's hanging in there. He's not gaining on the leaders, but they're not gaining on him either. He's just simply hanging in there. But there is another almost 200 miles to go. The thing that I want to know is, what are they going to do when they make the next pit stop, if this thing should go green flag to the next pit stop? Are they going to change two tires, or are they going to change four tires? And it may make a difference on who's going to win the race.
The question is he hanging in there or is he waiting? I gamble that he's waiting and that Walter's really going to be a factor before this one stops. More from Rockingham Live shortly. 12 of 492 laps are complete. For Benny Parsons, I'm Ken Squire at the STP Pit Center. Dave Despain, Chris Economaki, and Jerry Garrett alongside in the pits. We're watching as car number three, Earnhardt, continues to try and fend off Morgan Shepherd. Meanwhile, back in third spot, Darrell Waltrip is there, and his teammate, Neil Bonnett, rides right behind him in fourth and doesn't seem willing to challenge at this time. Ricky Rudd is in fifth. Harry Gant, with a very ill-handling car number 33, is in sixth. Buddy Baker is in seventh, and that completes the cars in the lead lap. Richard Petty is being shown one lap down in eighth. Bill Elliott, ninth. Wallace, tenth. Hillen, 11th. Joe Ruttman has come up to 12th with the Quaker State car.
Alan Kowicki, we talked about him, one of the Rookie of the Year challengers, coming down pit road. I don't know if this is a scheduled pit stop or not. If it is, we're going to see the other cars coming in very, very soon.
13th place, Alan Kowicki hitting his machine as the leaders continue. They rumble around this mile track, and Earnhardt continues to lead. Now, there's the 33 car again. And what Dave Despain mentioned earlier, watch this thing sashay. He's really had some problems with it. Putting a lap on Skinner in car number 19.
Harry Gant running higher than anyone off the racetrack, going right up against the concrete barrier, and several times almost hitting the concrete barrier as he goes in turns three and tries to come off turn four. There we see him going up the racetrack. Well, he's real low that time.
Look at him seesaw. He tries to handle that wheel and keep that thing straight. Meanwhile, up in front, there's the battle. And it just stays that way as if Morgan wants to wait, take his shot. Dale Earnhardt out in front. You know, he says he's a better driver now than in 1980 when he won his first championship.
Got more experience. You know, a lot more races behind me. I think I drive a better race now than what I did. I think a smarter race. You know, it takes a while to learn how to drive a 500-mile race. You just don't go out there and do it. You're good at it all of a sudden. I'm still learning today. I think with each race and each year I run, it's like with this team, we learn a little bit about racing. As long as I think we do that, we'll keep doing it.
It's magic how some teams finally really come together, congeal. The Harry Hyde, Kim Richmond story, which we explored a little earlier. And let's not forget Richard Childress. This has really worked out. Richard Childress, who back in the 60s, I first knew as a Grand American driver, a likable guy, worked so hard, never had the bucks, but he kept trying. Then he was a driver in Winston Cup racing. He would come close, but he was always 5th to 10th in that echelon. He went into the team business. The critics said he'll be 5th to 10th. Well, look what he did. He got Earnhardt involved. Earnhardt believed in him and vice versa. And here they are on top of the world. They are so strong together. And the behind-the-scenes award from Motor Week, the U.S. Air Force Reserve Wrangler folks, went to Richard Childress for the kind of power that he gave Earnhardt to make up two laps and win at Charlotte the last time out. You talk about Hyde and Richmond. You talk about some of those other great combinations. Childress and Earnhardt seem to be made for each other.
Richard Childress, the one thing I like about Richard Childress is that he is the only owner out there that builds his own race car. Harry Hyde, Travis Carter, the Morgan Shepherd crew, the Raymock people, they all go buy their race cars and just finish them. Richard Childress builds his car from the ground up. He knows everything about that race car. Richard Childress, one of the coming owners in this sport.
That's the number three car. And he may go to the Waldorf Astoria as owner of the year. With the way Earnhardt's running today, you could almost tap the championship with the finish of this Nationwise American 500 at Rockingham. If he could finish 10th in the last three races here, then Atlanta, then Riverside, it would be his. Right now, he's running up in front and just running away. And as we mentioned earlier, the attrition continues. The odds get so much better if those back markers fall out of this race. It just gives you more of a pat in the stand.
If they would throw the checkered flag right now, I think that Earnhardt would have the championship won. He would have to finish almost last at both Atlanta and Riverside for Darrell Walker to have a chance.
How do you feel right now to get down into this part of the race, Ben? Not as hot as it has been on some occasions at Rockingham, but lap after lap, trying to focus and concentrate on this racetrack, knowing that if for 1 second your concentration wavers, you could be history and lose the $60,000 car. That's a trick here.
It is a trick, and it's happened to me here before, driving Bud Moore's car, the car that Ricky Rudd is driving today. Going in turn three, I lost my concentration for just a moment, turned a little bit too soon, touched J.D. McDuffie. I spun the car back up into the outside retaining wall and put me out of the race. So you're right. You have to concentrate every inch of the way, and it becomes very difficult, particularly at this point, because they look at the scoreboard. They know there's 175 laps to go. They aren't stupid, and it just takes a lot out of them.
Meanwhile, it looks like Shepherd is trying to turn up the aggression in his automobile as he comes after the Earnhardt car out in the front-running position. Waltrip still lies in that fourth spot. How do you battle in the fourth spot? Neil Bonnet's moved around him for the moment. They're just swapping back and forth. We asked Earl, how do you battle fatigue at the end of a long race like this?
One of the hardest things in racing is to be racing as hard as you can go and be worn out, and they give halfway. The cross flag, your hat, and say, oh my Lord, I'm only halfway. You really have to, a lot of times, just pull yourself together. You reach up and rub your neck a little bit, and straighten up in the seat a little bit, tighten the belt a little bit, and grit your teeth and go on. And the guys that can do that are the guys that win races. That's the difference probably between winning and losing, is being able to pull yourself together that last hour of the race, that last 50 miles of the race. Give that little bit more. Give that little extra. Those are the guys that win. The other guys, they're the ones that slide down in the seat and their head leaning over against the door and hanging on for dear life just to get finished. It's tough, Ken, and the older I get, the harder it gets.
Those front four, there's no sliding down in the seat on those guys. There's Earnhardt in first. Morgan Shepherd in the number 75 car for Raymock in second, coming to the outside, and it looks like number three, is he coming to pit?
Yes, Earnhardt's coming in the pits. His crew is ready. Now, what's he going to do? Change right? Change left, change four tires.
Let's go to Jerry Garrett.
Well, down here, they're going to change left side tires, Ken. They decided that those are the ones that have the most miles on them. They changed right sides on the last pit stop. If they had gone to the rights again, then these left side tires would have had nearly 200 miles on them. Here go two cans of fuel. Looks like a regular stop. No chassis change, and he's away.
16 and 5 tenths of a second on the stop by Dale Earnhardt in car number three, and back underway.
remember something here. The last time we had a pit stop, we ran an awful lot of green flag here in a row. Earnhardt was the second man to come in. Shepard stopped ahead of him. Remember, we talked about Shepard being out of sync. Earnhardt stopped later than Morgan. This time he had to stop earlier. It could have been the tires and not the fuel that brought him in. And so now it may be Earnhardt who's a little out of sync in his pit stop. It'll be interesting to see how soon Morgan, Shepard, Neil Bonnet, and Darrell Walker hit pit road.
Back to seventh falls Dale Earnhardt after that pit stop. And Morgan Shepherd trying to give Raymock Racing their first win since 1983 in the Atlanta Journal 500 is the current leader. Now we're showing 330 complete. 330 of the 492 laps that make the distance. Still some racing to do out here.
There is still some racing to do. And the Morgan Shepherd crew, I see them just moving around back there trying to get ready to bring Morgan in, make that pit stop, and I wonder what they're going to do. And those decisions right now, that's what Darrell Waltrip is in the catbird seat right now, because all of his competitors can stop, he can see what they do, and then he can decide what he wants to do.
One of the stories that may have escaped us and we ought to get back to is Neil Bonnet played for about 20 laps, and here comes Morgan Shepherd on pit road behind Waltrip, and now he's extending himself. Let's go to Chris Economaki.
Okay, 97 laps on this tank full of fuel, and this is also a left side tire change. Morgan is turning down the drink. He waves the fluids away. He's talking to his crew on the radio. It looks like there's a lot of men over the pit wall here. You can count six and four. That was a fast one, far faster than Earnhardt. Back to you.
Ah, yes, it was indeed about 15.4 on that pit stop. Gives Neil Bonnet the lead. He collects 5 points. Bonnet has taken the lead momentarily here. Waltrip is in second. Rudd is in third. Gant comes to fourth. And in the Buick, the Quaker State car of Joe Ruttman, we get this view as the sun gets a little longer here. Joe Ruttman currently up in the 12th position. More in a moment.
Consideration paid by STP. For nearly three decades, America has been driving and winning with STP.
STP is the racer's edge.
And by True Value.
When you do it yourself, do it right. With professional quality master mechanic tools, exclusively from participating True Value hardware stores and home centers.
STP Pit Communication Center at Rockingham, North Carolina Motor Speedway. We talked earlier about the three fastest cars in yesterday's final practice session. Tim Richmond led the race early, broke, went away. Jeff Bodine ran third early, broke, went away. The third car in that group, nowhere near the front of the starting lineup, was Neil Bonnet. Look who's here. Neil Bonnet is leading the race as the other two front runners, Dale Earnhardt and the number 75 car of Morgan Shepherd, have come on pit road. Now, Bonnet's got a pit stop coming up. But keep in mind, this guy's hungry. He's been down. He's only been in the top five six times this year. He's pumped up. He wants to win this race. And he's at the top of the field right now.
Thank you, Dave. Ricky Rudd has just pitted and gone back on the track. And now you see Harry Gant on pit road among those leaders. It was 15 seconds flat on the stop for car number 33. Any adjustments there, Benny?
No, I don't think so. I think they just changed the left side. Just everyone has changed left sides. I was wondering who was going to change forward to rights, left. Everyone has changed the left side tires. The only two cars on the lead lap that haven't pitted is the Neil Bonnet car and the Darrell Waltrip car, both Junior Johnson cars.
So here's Neil Bonnet coming by, who hasn't won a race since back in 1985 at North Wilkesboro, the first race at North Wilkesboro. Been a while. He would like to turn things around here this afternoon. Bill Elliott pitting, currently shown in ninth. Everything's better with Neil Bonnet on it. And first place has Bonnet on it right now.
First place is the best thing Neil Bonnet's seen in a long time, because you're right. Neil Bonnet has had a horrible year.
Very secretive among those teams. We'll get to that in a moment. Let's take a look at the attrition in this race. See who has dropped out. Ronnie Thomas, Buddy Boys, Johnny Coy Jr., Milliken's gone. Trevor Boyce has been eliminated. Tommy Ellis after a slide and some problems. Dave Marcus lost what appeared to be an engine in a big way. Cale Yarborough by the wayside. Bodine had his troubles after a spin. Terry Labonte has gone to back. Bobby Wowak, that car that we saw that looked like it had a problem up on the right front. Jonathan Edwards, he too has succumbed. and Rusty Wallace's car number 27. That's a bad story on the Raymond Beadle, Barry Dotson prepared car. Now look at number 25, 48 laps down, still in here and still taking the lap back from Neil Bunn.
Ken, just a quick note on that attrition for the folks in South Carolina. Jonathan Edwards, in fact, is out of the race, but not because his car broke, but because he's ill. And so another driver, Bobby Wawak, who had retired his car with a broken motor, has climbed in. And so the car 27 is, in fact, back out on the racetrack. Let's go to Jerry Garrett. He's on pit road.
Well, thanks, Dave. We've been down here talking to some of the crews. And on that last tank of gas, Dale Earnhardt got 89 laps. Now, Ricky Rudd, who's in a Ford, which supposedly gets worse mileage, got 99. Now, Neil Bonnett, Darrell Waltrip, and Chevy's, they both are getting over 100 laps. So I guess Dale Earnhardt has got a fuel mileage problem in this one.
That's the story from Jerry Garrett along pit road as we watch car number 12, Neil Bonnett, knowing that he has to come in shortly here and refuel.
He sure does, and there's no way in the world that he can make the distance. He can't run far enough to get gas and then go up and just make one more stop before the end of the race. He has to stop twice.
Let's review further back down. We keep talking about Bonnett, Waltrip, now Baker in third, Shepard in fourth, Earnhardt fifth, Gant sixth, Rudd seventh, Richard Petty lap down in eighth, Bill Elliott in ninth, Bobby Hillen in tenth, Joe Ruttman in 11th, now two laps down, with Alan Kulwicki 12th, Kyle Petty in 13th, and three laps down is Michael Waltrip, runner-up honor so far for Rookie of the Year to Waltrip in the points. Then comes Bobby Allison 15th, Ken Schrader 16th, and Mike Skinner is up to 17th. Darrell Waltrip is on pit road. Here's Waltrip coming in. Junior Johnson crew ready. Jeff Hammond and company awaiting Waltrip.
They're changing the left sides on Darrell's car just like everyone else. As he sits there, the Rusty Wallace car, you'll see him go by in just a moment. He's back into the action. Darrell, the Junior Johnson crew, finishes the pit stop back on the racetrack.
So Wallace's car, which had gone back to the garage area, now is back on the speedway, still trying to score points. 14.01 seconds was the way they recorded that stop on Waltrip, and they're now preparing
pit stop
for Neil Bonnett. They say there's some damage showing on Richard Petty's car number 43, but he stays out here on the track. Side of the car is all scummed up.
The leader, Neil Bonnett, going down pit road. Neil Bonnett going down pit road. The crew's waiting. It's a left side tire change on his car as well.
Excellent stop on the Bonnett car. Getting a little lengthy here.
Oh, the gas man is very, very slow. The exchange was not good. Neil Bonnett said, please clean the windshield. Clean the windshield, he's saying.
He's away. And that was costly.
It was costly. Looked like the pit stop was a few seconds longer than some of his competition.
20 and a half?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a hurter. Now there's Baker in 88.
I think he's the leader of the race right now. He hasn't
sure
stopped
is.
This for this pit stop, and so he right now is the leader.
Andy Baker, he came out of that 11th qualifying position, did well on the very first day. His own team, as we mentioned. I think he's really ready to duck in here.
Yes, Baker coming down pit road. Now what's he going to do? Left, right, four?
3 seconds, no wins here. He finished third four times. Boy, would he like to turn that around for new sponsor.
The crew going to the left side on that car. Someone handing him a drink of water.
What you were talking about with his new crew chief may be demonstrated right here.
There, they're cleaning the windshield on Buddy's car.
Boy, that's efficient. Two tires and fuel.
Good stop. I didn't get the seconds on that, but it was a good stop.
Looked like it was under 15 seconds for sure on that one. And Baker's back underway. Now, with these pit stops, the circumstance comes back to this. We have Morgan Shepherd in first, Earnhardt in second, and Petty for the moment is being shown in third.
Well, Richard has not stopped. He hasn't made his pit stop, and all the rest of the cars have. So as soon as he makes his pit stop, he'll go back in the position where he should be.
354 laps are complete. 354 down. There's that number 75, Morgan Shepherd, showing up like a shiny penny another time.
Boy, when they went back on the racetrack, the Earnhardt car, which is in front of Morgan Shepherd. Morgan passed him and just is driving away from Earnhardt. He must have had a 4 or 5 second lead advantage on Dale Earnhardt right now.
Let's see if the number three car of Earnhardt can make another run. He's done it twice this afternoon. The interval stands at what, 3.5 seconds?
3.5 seconds.
3.5 between this man, number three, Earnhardt, in second place and the leader. And now Richard Petty is on pit road. And Petty's car looks like it has survived the Battle of the Bulls today. All down one side. The number is missing. A lot of the old Petty blue paint has gone away. Throws out a towel as he sits there.
That was Dale Inman over there pulling the sheet metal away, making sure that he was going to miss, that the sheet metal was off the tire. Left side's on Richard Petty's car. He's back in action.
17 1/10 of a second on Richard Petty in car number 43.
So that's the leader right now. Everyone has made their pit stops. That's the leader. Morgan Shepherd up against that outside retaining wall.
And he used 2 hands to hold on to that one.
As I said a moment ago, if anyone can run high and save a car, it's he and Harry Ginn.
Running 11th, Joe Rutman started back in 1963 in Riverside, California with his first NASCAR race. We'll be back with more here at the Nationwise American 500 shortly. Mentioning that his first appearance in NASCAR racing was 1963 at Riverside. That was when he was 18 years old. And he finished 10th that day. And, of course, his famed brother Troy was also in that race. He came home in pretty good shape in third spot. So it's been a long time that Rutman has been around in NASCAR racing. Took a lot of years off to run short track, a lot of years of work as a mechanic. But he's come on, and I hope that he gets a good ride next year. He's working this car, number 26, all over the racetrack. He lost a lap because of a consultation flag, and he's been having his handling problems, too. The rabbit's foot has kept him in this race.
It probably has worked. There we can see the windshield and just how dirty it is. That's what Neil Bonnet was asking for a moment ago, to clean his windshield off, because remember this in-car camera at the earlier part of the race, we could see through the windshield perfectly. Now it's very difficult to see what's in front of the car.
I always like what Petty said about the rabbit's feet. He said, I don't think they're so lucky. It never worked out very well for the bunny. Let's take a look at the standings here. Take a look at where we are in the standings. Morgan Shepherd in first. There's Dale Earnhardt second. Waltrip now finds himself in third. Bonnet, after leading back to fifth. Ricky Rudd is in sixth, and Baker is in seventh. Richard Petty now a lap or two down in the eighth position.
And one more little footnote, if you will, about the visibility situation, and Benny, I'm sure, can comment on this. We'll probably see it later on in the race from our in-car camera. As the sun settles in the west here at Rockingham, it's shining right into the driver's eyes as they come up the front straightaway. A lot of people think the entrance to turn one is the most critical point on the racetrack. We talk about two, the exit of two being the scene of so many of the disasters, but that's because you don't get into one in the right place. If you get into one wrong, you're going to crash in two. And getting into one gets pretty tricky, doesn't it, Benny, when the sun gets down and starts to shine right through an oily, dirty windshield into your eyes.
That's so true, Dave Despain. I remember once here, the race was rained, and we had to run it after November the 1st, and daylight saved. The time had went away. We were back on Eastern Standard Time, and about 400 laps in the race, I couldn't see anything. I had to use the white line down on the apron to determine when I got to the corner and was to turn the steering wheel. I couldn't see the turn, not at all.
Well, there you see Morgan Shepherd, and there is that second-place car, and there's a fair interval between them as Dale Earnhardt tries to overcome Shepherd another time. Dale Earnhardt has used youth and enthusiasm to win that first national championship back in 1980. If he wins this year, different tactics will have helped him.
In 1980, Dale Earnhardt's victory at Charlotte gave him the push he needed to hold off Cale Yarborough for the national championship. The closest margin in history, 19 points, separated Dale and Cale. This year, Earnhardt won Charlotte again and is apparently on his way to his second national title. The Dale Earnhardt who won that first title 7 years ago was a spunky 28-year-old tour sophomore. He now has a far different reputation. Nowadays, Earnhardt is known as the most physical driver on the circuit. If you don't move over for Dale Earnhardt, he'll move you over. And what does Dale Earnhardt have to say about his reputation?
You race all day and you get down there to the last lap and you get your front end in there,
and the guy tries to cut you off, or he tries to do what he can to keep you back there, you stand your ground. And a lot of times it comes out bad, but a lot of times you win races too.
Well, he's got to come from 7.5 seconds back if he wants to get a fender under Morgan Shepherd here, but there's plenty of time to do it.
There is plenty of time, but just a few laps ago, that margin was 3.5 seconds, and Red, you said right now it's 7 seconds. Morgan Shepherd, we saw him yesterday in the Grand National race, and we said, this is unbelievable. Well, today is even as unbelievable because he is killing the competition, just driving away.
Well, down in the pits, either Chris or Jerry Garrett, if you get a moment to drop by the Raymock folks, we'd like to know how they feel about how that car is performing today. Doesn't look like it's missed a beat. It's been as strong a machine from lap one as it is now. When he's wanted to take it to the front, he could. When he wanted to bridle it, he could. He's done everything and run anywhere with car number 75.
You know, one other point about that 75 car, and that is the fact that back when Neil Bonnet used to drive that machine, it won a tremendous number of races. You know who's going to drive it again next year? Neil Bonnet. He's going back to Raymond for a reunion, leading Junior Johnson. I think they'll be strong again.
I don't think there's any question about that. That's going to be formidable. But the way things are building up for next year, you better have all your horses ready to come out quickly out of the gate, or you're going to get left real soon.
I tell you what, in our year next year, we're starting right now thinking about next year, and Leo Jackson and I have been having several conversations about what we've got to do next year to be competitive, because we know that 1987 will be the most competitive year that Winston Cup NASCAR racing has ever seen.
The man that could have a big factor in that is Benny Parsons and his brother Phil, because they're going to work as a combo tag team operation for you guys next year.
That's right. We watched the Rock and Roll Express do it, so we're going to try it. We're going to tag team next year. I'll run a race and then he can run a race.
Pass the baton during the race?
Well, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to pass it during the week.
Mark Stahl has dropped way slow, bottom of the track. He's idled down through turn one on the bottom. There's no caution for it, but he's off the pace considerably. There's 33, Harry Gant, currently in the fourth position. Has the handle got any better in this car? We'll see.
Let's follow Harry Gant's progress here a couple of more times. Harry, we said, was up to sixth. Now he's climbed into fourth spot. We talked about that visibility problem earlier, and indeed we visited with Harry Gant on that very subject. We asked him, how bad is the sun late in the race, Harry?
Well, you got a blind. It's blind you going into turn one, and you can't really see anything late in the day down there. And if it's a car in front, you absolutely can't see it the last 30 minutes or so of the race.
Well, how do you compensate for that?
Well, you just feel like if he's a fast car, he's going to be going as fast as you are. If it's a slower car down there, you just have to back off up here where you can see him, and then get your vision back. About halfway through the turn, the shadow sets in, you can start going again.
Visibility right now is the second biggest problem that Harry Gant's worried about. Number one is that handling problem that we've talked about off and on all through the race. Look at him go all the way up there to the concrete. Cars wiggling and skating around coming off the corners. We talked about all the tires he's used. By our count, Harry has burned up $4,000 worth of tires that they came here with. They bought $2,000 more in tires, $2,000 worth of tires, $6,000. Yes, there's $400,000 on the line here, but when you talk about just the guaranteed prize money, you got to be using a lot of manufacturer parts and stuff to get the bonus money. Guaranteed prize money for fourth place where he's running right now is $6,500. So he's got to stay up there just to pay the tire bill. Let's go to Chris Economaki on pit road.
Watch out in Morgan Shepherd's pit with Butch Mock, the crew chief. What does Morgan say about the car, how it's running and so forth, and can he stay there till the end of the race?
Yeah, I think we can. He said the car is really working real well, and we're in good shape. We got to make one more stop for fuel and possibly right or left on tires, but we're in good shape.
How long has it been since you put a wrench on the car?
What's that?
How long has it been since you put a wrench on the car and made an adjustment?
We haven't made an adjustment all day.
Well, that shows you a car that started out right and is still running right. Which marks the crew chief of the car out in front right now. Back to you, Kev.
There's the story. They haven't put a mitt on that car. Morgan Shepherd continuing to look as stout as anything in the field with car number 75.
Earnhardt on pit road. Dale Earnhardt, Winston Cup leader, on pit road, an unscheduled pit stop.
Here he comes, rolling down pit road. The number three car is into the pits.
The hood goes up.
Here's Jerry Garrett.
Well, whatever it was, Ken, it happened all of a sudden because the crew was sitting around here on tires taking a nap almost.
They're putting a can of fuel in, but they stopped. No more cans of fuel. Looking under the hood over in the ignition area. I don't know what it could be. We'll check and get back with you.
Let's watch here as Dale Earnhardt trying for the championship that he won in 1980. Has eluded him since. Darrell Waltrip came back to win it. Hood's going down. They're going to get him back in the race.
Looks like the car is running. It was moving forward. Yes,
losing
it is.
A lap, 34 and 8 tenths seconds. 34.8 is the time that he was in the pits, and he goes down two laps. .382 complete, and they're reporting Earnhardt down two as he comes back on the track. And the situation is this: Sheppard leads Waltrip. The challenger to Earnhardt to take the championship in 86 goes to second place. Harry Gant comes to third. Bonnet to fourth. Rudd to fifth. Buddy Baker in sixth, all in the lead lap. So, a major change here in the Nationwise American 500, and more on that story in a moment.
Shades of a year ago, Bill Elliott came here with a point lead and crashed. And Darrell Waltrip won the race and went on to take the title. Now today, Dale Earnhardt comes here with a point lead. He's just gone to the pits for two costly laps after running first or second all day. Here is Waltrip in second spot and in position to do it again. What happened to Dale Earnhardt? Let's find out from Jerry Jarrett.
We're down here and Richard Childress is talking to Dale right now. What happened to Dale?
The ignition went out on the car.
Did the oil wire come off or what?
No, one of the electronic boxes just went out on it.
And you got to start it almost immediately. Do you wish you had changed tires on that stop now?
Yeah, we wish we could have, but we didn't have time. We had to get the car going first.
Richard Childress in communication now with Dale Earnhardt. And all of a sudden, once again, Darrell Waltrip, who won at Rockingham in those years of 81, 82, and 85, and then went out of the championship, he begins to cast a far deeper shadow on this Nationwise American 500. Traditionally, it's win at the Rock for Darrell Waltrip and win the championship.
Well, that's a good scenario. It has worked, but, you know, as you can see, we're in a tough situation here with the points the way they are. And last year we caught Bill earlier, and we were able to get a little bit of a lead on him, and I think psychologically that done him in. This year, you know, we're only got three races to go, and we're 159 points behind. And I don't like to fool myself, and I don't like to go around telling people I can do something I can't. And I can't win this championship unless my friend over there has a little bit of trouble.
Well, his friend has had a little bit of trouble. It's not a knockout, but it's hurting him a little. And here at the Rock, someone looks slightly unconscious there.
Well, I think it's been a long afternoon for the young lady.
She might have been listening to Woodwind Quintet in the interview. Being pushed back behind the wall.
Bobby Allison's car. Bobby out for the day.
Brad Christensen and Rusty Wallace is back on the track. Meanwhile, Morgan Sheppard here to fourth. Best finish fifth. Been here since 81 in this race. Here's Allison's car, rolled away. Morgan Shepherd's efforts on this track. He's crashed once. I know he's had at least one engine failure in this race. And he's had 1 5th and 1 6th place finish. Here's that car going, that little camel jump there as it moves around.
As it comes off turn two, that little bump coming off turn two that gets the unsuspected so many times.
And while all the other crews have been flailing through this afternoon, crew on this, they changed some tires, put in some gas, as they continue to try to move Morgan around to win his third, and nary a problem.
Let's talk a moment more about the little problem here for Darrell Waltrip's friend, Dale Earnhardt. It's important, I think, to note that this ignition situation that has brought him into the pits for two laps should not be an ongoing problem. Those cars have
basically repetitive or duplicate redundant systems, if you will. They have electronic ignition, the so-called black box that makes the spark plugs fire. If the black box goes bad, you just plug it into the spare black box and you've got a brand new ignition. It's not the kind of problem that should recur, that should deteriorate, or that should give Dale Earnhardt any additional headaches more than what he's already got. His headache now is this. He is two laps down, but he is still in ninth place in the race, and that's not a bad spot to be. Even if Darrell Walker wins it today, Dale Earnhardt is in pretty good shape. Let's go down to Jerry Garrett, who's on pit road.
We're down here with one of the drivers that's out of the race now, Bobby Allison. He's had a long, tough day, changed his shock absorber. He's had a variety of problems. I'm going to get a word with him here in just a minute to see what happened to him. Bobby, what put you in the garage area finally?
I'm sitting in the garage area. I couldn't hear the rest of what you said, but just a rough day for us. A part on the car broke, and then the tailpipe broke, and then the engine broke. I drove my heart out, but we just didn't have any luck today at all.
You've had a real tough stretch in the points right now. You were fourth at one time. You're back down to 10th or something now. It's got to be awfully frustrating.
Well, we got to be able to finish the races to be any, do any good in the points. I just hope that the crew will work real hard and try to get the car reliable for the next race. And, Judy and my mom and dad and her mom and dad and all the folks back home are pulling for us, but we got to have the car stay together to have a chance at it.
Okay, well, thanks, Bobby. Now down to Chris Economaki.
Well, looking at the scoreboard, we see that we've reached that point in the race where any fuel stops made now will take the car to the very finish. So the men in the pit are going to play the role. The quicker the stop, the further forward the car will finish. It's getting over. Back to you, Ken.
400 laps are complete, as Chris indicated, and the distance today is that long sought after 492. Morgan Shepherd would like to have it end right now. There's some others that would certainly like to change that. Allison was talking about his trying to sustain himself in these races. Again, those points, he has dropped to eighth position in the points. He fell four spots in one event, which was a heartbreaker for him.
Morgan Shepherd has a problem.
Morgan
Shepherd has a problem down in turn one. He's off the pace. The car dramatically slowing as he went down in turn one, Ken.
Drops to the inside.
He evidently got some oil. I don't know what happened there.
See if he brushed the wall.
The 64 car we see, I saw him smoking going down in turn one.
He's right behind that 64 front, and there is Morgan's car. This is going to push Waltrip into second. Into first, Gant into second, Bonnet into third, and Rudd into fourth. Do you believe it? Here is Morgan Shepherd, nary a miss, everything going, and all of a sudden, cardiac arrest. Car number 75 is going directly back to the garage area. No wait, no hesitate, it's over for Morgan Shepherd after this performance that looked like it was going to carry him all the way. Waltrip is in front. Gant is in second. Earnhardt back in the ninth position. There he is. And remember, three times he's been champion. Each time he has won this race. And he's leading in sight of the finish. More from the Nationwise American 500 in a moment.
Listen to the heartbeat.
When you want to feel the thunder, put yourself in today's Chevrolet Camaro.
We're back at the Nationwide 500 at Rockingham, where Darrell Waltrip leads, and this is the man who was leading. And what happened to you, Morgan Shepherd?
Well, I don't know yet, but I think the drive shaft broke in it.
The car was hooked up. It looked like it was on rails all day until then.
Yeah, the car really worked great. You know, I just really hate it for Nationwide. They sponsored this race and sponsored this car. We really hope we can pull off a win for them.
Anybody out there now that you think is a favorite to win?
Well, I'd say it'd be between Darrell or Dale Earnhardt, most likely.
Okay, well, Dale's down a couple of laps, but Darrell's out in front.
Well,
Let me add a point to the Morgan Shepherd problem there that Benny may be able to comment on. A broken drivetrain component. Now, that's a very vulnerable part of the automobiles here at Rockingham. On this mile racetrack, these corners are tight. You got a lot of bank. The drivetrain, the rear ends, the drive shafts really take a tremendous amount of abuse, and especially at the pace we're running here today. We're 5 miles an hour above the old lap record at 400 laps. In other words, they've run 400 laps, 5 miles an hour average faster than ever before. There's tremendous strain on that particular component. It's cost Morgan Shepherd the win here today.
411 laps are complete. 5 cars are in the lead lap. Darrell Waltrip is in first. Harry Gantt second. Neil Bonnet third. Ricky Rudd fourth. And Buddy Baker is deployed fifth. Richard Petty is in sixth. There you see Petty still scurrying on with Bill Elliott in seventh. Earnhardt 2 laps down is in eighth. And remember, if he could finish 10th in the last 3 races of the year, he would still sew up the championship. Earnhardt in 8th, and we've seen him make up a couple of laps in a matter of 18 just a race ago. Going in 9th is Joe Ruttman, up to 10th Hillen, Kyle Petty 11th, Alan Kulwicki is going 12th, Kenny Schrader 13th, Bierswall 14th, and Buddy Arrington is into 15th.
How about that? There we see the leader, Darrell Waltrip, going around the racetrack. We had the camera just a moment ago on Richard Petty, and I tell you, we followed Harry Gantt around the racetrack earlier on, but Richard Petty has been fighting up struggle all day. He's had to cut the car sideways a dozen times. Darrell, meanwhile, he's hung in there all day. Car really doesn't seem to be that bad. He's just going around the racetrack on the bottom of the racetrack right now.
Trying to pick up his 71st win. Dick Trickle is back on pit road another time. It's been an on-again, off-again afternoon for the ASA champion, Trickle, in car number 42. There he is another time for right side tires. Now let's see if we can get some intervals out here so you can get a better picture of how this race is laid out. Waltrip has the advantage, and it's a fairly fat one at the present time. There he is over Harry Gantt, the number 33, running the second position. And we'll get the interval first to second for you, then check on Neil Bonnet in third and Ricky Rudd in fourth. And all these leaders, with the exception of the Waltrip car, seem to be darting a lot up here, particularly in turn four. You really have to take a second, third, and sometimes fourth step to come off turn four and keep it straight.
Yeah, Herku is in second place. Our friend Harry Gantt, who's been running that high group all day, goes in low right to the top of the racetrack. Well, he's in the middle of the racetrack this time.
Better. 3 7/10 of a second down, Benny.
And Harry Gantt, what a job he has done today. Kept the car in contention and is only 3 7/10 behind the leader. There we see him up against the outside retaining wall.
Earned his money all afternoon. He's really had a handful here. Now Neil Bonnet is third. And we'll check the interval from second back to the third position and see where Bonnet rests in all of this. The Baker tribe have got to be happy how Buddy has done today, holding on to that fifth spot and not going down a lap. Actually, he had been left by Morgan Shepherd, who just drawn away from him. But when Morgan retired, it put Baker back in the lead lap. It's 4 seconds between second and third. 4 seconds from Gantt back to Neil Bonnet, the number 12 car that is running in third spot. Waltrip out in front. Who would have believed it? Jeff Hammond says his job, crew chief for Darrell Waltrip, this race isn't that much different than it's been all year.
Same situation when we start out in Daytona, and we try to make sure everything is exactly right. But at this point in the season, everybody really realizes what's at stake. It's either different between being first or second in points right now. If we do our homework and get a little bit of luck to go our way, possibly we'll be back in New York in December celebrating another championship. If not, we want to make darn sure we don't finish any worse than second, so that you know, we feel like we've had a good year and had a real good relationship with Darrell and go out on a good note.
419 laps are complete and more on this car number 11 from the old master himself. Let's go to the pits.
Okay, I'm down here with Junior Johnson. Junior, Darrell will be coming in about 30 laps or so for his last stop. What's going to happen during that final stop?
Probably get two right side tires, just get the tires and gas and go.
The chassis needs adjusting, you say?
It's a little bit off yet. We haven't really hit the right combination yet. We will make adjustment on it.
You don't believe in leaving well enough alone, huh, Junior?
Well, Harry's as quick as we are right now, and we need to try to better that.
Okay, thanks very much. And there you have it, right from the horse's mouth. Back to you again.
Junior Johnson, who back in 1965 and 66 was in this race. ended pretty good in 66 when he came home with a fourth place finish. Down there now, massaging the hopes of Darrell Waltrip to take another step toward an unprecedented fourth crown. And he would really have to have all the luck in the world, the right saint, everything go from here on to pull it off.
He would, but Darrell Waltrip's been very fortunate in his years in Winston Cup racing. And if anybody can pull it off, it's Junior Johnson, the Junior Johnson and his crew, along with Darrell Waltrip.
You know, Junior led the first lap that was ever run in this racetrack.
Is that right?
Competition.
You
yep.
guys can run some of the most amazing stuff.
Here and there.
Here and there. Looks to me like Harry Gant may even be getting a little closer than to Darrell Waltrip than he was just a few laps ago.
Three and a half seconds. Was four,
so he's gained a half a second. So maybe Junior's right. Maybe they better adjust the chassis on the next pit stop.
Joe Rutmans hangs in here and gets into the top 10 in his effort this afternoon with a Quaker State car. More live from the Nationwise American 500 after this. Circumstances have changed once again. Bobby Wowak driving the Edwards car, number 92, has collected the wall. Not hard, but just enough to bring out the caution. And in doing so, all of the front of the field has pitted. And as they came down pit road, the man who came out first, how about Harry Gant in car number 33? And how about the slowest pit stop being made by Darrell Waltrip?
Had some serious problem with the left side of the car. I don't know if it was the rear or the front, but had some problem changing tires on the Budweiser Chevrolet. And Darrell now is about fourth or fifth.
So the field is down the back stretch behind the pace car. And number 33, Harry Gant, looking for his first win of the year. Wouldn't it be great for Travis Carter and company if they could put it together here this afternoon?
Last time out, Charlotte Motor Speedway, Dale Earnhardt made up two laps under and a period of 18 laps of the race and came back and won it. Obviously, the yellow flags played a big factor in that. Earnhardt stayed out on the racetrack. He has made up one of his laps. We'll see how this all unscrambles at the end of the pit stop sequence. He may yet come in, but if not, there's the possibility he's going to be on the tail end of the lead lap. He'll be halfway back. Let's go to Jerry Garrett. He's on pit road.
Well, Dave, Harry Gant was in here just a few minutes ago and got $500 more worth of Goodyear tires. But an interesting thing, they didn't put a wrench on the car. Crew Chief Travis Carter says it's handling just the way Harry wants it now. Loose.
Well, it is that. I'll guarantee you that's the truth. It is that. Loose. There we see Harry Gant following the pace car. I bet he thought he would never end up leading this race about halfway through.
Field coming down out of the corner with Gant now in the lead. For years, The Rock has been instrumental in deciding the Winston Cup Championship. This track holds special memories for all the drivers, including our own Benny Parsons.
For more than 20 years, Rockingham has been deciding Winston Cup Championship. And it isn't easy. As you can tell by the marks on the wall, it's a tough racetrack. In 1973, I only had to run about half the race to clinch the championship. On the 13th lap, coming off the second corner, a car spun. I got into him, completely destroyed my car. But the crew spent an hour and 15 minutes repairing it. I was able to go on and win the championship. Nothing comes easy at Rockingham.
There are some guys who had better luck here than I did. Richard Petty dominated stock car racing in the early and mid-70s. He won six championships, and twice he won this race en route to the title. Of course, Richard lives right down the road, and this is his home track. Cale Yarbrough is the only guy to win three straight titles, and he clinched two of them here, one with a race victory. In 1980, the yellow and blue number two of Dale Earnhardt dodged this big crash, then he left home 18th. He had a huge point lead, but this one race almost cost him the title. Darrell Waltrip is the guy this place has really smiled upon. Three times a win at Rockingham has helped carry him to the championship. Has he used up all of his Rockingham luck, or can Darrell do it again this afternoon?
We're going to find out right now. They've just gone back under green. As they came to green, Gant first, Bonnet second, Rutt third, Walter fourth, Baker fifth, front left.
The Earnhardt right now is the story, Ken Squire, the third car we saw right there. Kent, he is trying to get his lap back. Neil Bonnet going for the lead. He's alongside Harry Gant, takes the lead coming off the second corner. But can these two cars keep Dale Earnhardt behind them? I doubt it very seriously.
430 laps are now complete as Neil Bonnet once again goes to the point. Gant is in second. One lap has been made up by Earnhardt. When Morgan Shepherd went down, that gave Earnhardt an opportunity, who had cleared out all the other traffic back in there, to take one lap back. He'd like to take another here. Here he is to the inside. Remember that Earnhardt is being shown currently as, I believe, seventh on the field. He's moving around Elliott.
Oh, he hits Harry Gant. Pushes Harry Gant up out of the way, makes some contact.
He's getting determined. He's getting down to showtime here, and he comes up through. He's beginning to muscle a little, and Earnhardt, lap down, going for the leader now, which is Neil Bonnet.
And there's Ricky Rudd going past Harry Gant for second spot, or trying to get by Harry Gant. They're side by side as they go in turn three. Harry back up to his high groove, Rudd on the inside.
Bottom side, Ricky Rudd, the red and white car, the Ford Thunderbird. Buick, Bonnet, or Chevrolet on the outside. Here they are, wheel to wheel, back to the first turn. Good, even battle. Rudd for the moment. Rudd for the position. The 15 car, Ricky Rudd, is now second, Gant third, Waltrip lurking in fourth, Baker in fifth.
Ooh, Harry Gant gets the car sideways up in the middle of the corner. He just can't stay down on the bottom of the racetrack. The car gets too loose.
Tell you what, that number nine car of Elliott is in seventh. 138-mile-an-hour average in the last lap. Checking on those positions around the track, it is 7th on Elliott. High side of the racetrack. Harry Gant, number 33, and Elliott dives down beneath him.
Harry Gant was doing okay when everyone was out there with hot tires, but now they've got cold tires, new tires. They're able to run on the bottom of the racetrack, and Harry can't. He has to go to the top of the racetrack, and his competition just driving by him.
He fades. Let's go to Chris Economak.
Well, you remember the story for one of a nail, the shoe was lost and so on, and the war was lost. Well, you're looking at the jack that may well have cost Al Walker the championship. This is a standard jack, but they're modified for racing. And during the course of the stop, if something broke on the jack, and this is supposed to come up when the jack is worked, and that's why Al Walker was in the pits for as long as he was, because this jack let him down.
No, I didn't lift him up.
It wasn't helpful. Here is Bonnet. So long since he's tasted victory. And that car seems to be on the right track. However, that hasn't helped anybody this afternoon. Richmond looked so good in the early going. Had it all working. Morgan Shepherd dominated. Cale Yarborough looked strong.
Dale Earnhardt looked very strong. And Dale still is out there, and he still is strong. But right now, he isn't gaining on Neil Bonnet. As a matter of fact, I think Bonnet is pulling a few car lengths ahead.
Sun blazing down into that first turn, blind vision as you go up into turn one. Let's watch it from Rutland's perspective here. Here he comes down the main straightaway, about to take on that first turn, and it glimmers up into his goggles.
That's about what he sees, folks. Nothing.
Well, actually, I think our camera does better than what you can see as a driver in that position.
I think you're probably right, because the camera is back in the shadows.
Now, car number 15, Richie Rudd, who is in the second position, is being challenged by number 3. The 15 and the 3 are getting together out here, and Earnhardt is definitely making a last lap run to get himself up here and take one more shot at getting through traffic.
There we see the Earnhardt car going high on the racetrack. Ricky Rudd's right on the bottom of the racetrack.
Here comes Elliott. Earnhardt is now to 6. Into 7th is Elliott. Back to 8 goes Pettit. 5 cars lead lap. Bonnet first, Rudd second, Gant third, Waltrip fourth, Baker fifth. 52 laps left. 52 to go. It's been a great scrap, and it's a long way.
Oh, Earnhardt gets the car sideways coming off the fourth corner, but he's able to save it. But Rudd pulls up right on his rear bumper.
Rudd may try to take a lap back here. Interesting situation. Some Ford fans wanting to see Ricky Rudd, or maybe some Waltrip fans. You know, for all the booing you hear about Waltrip, have you seen the latest in the standings for most popular drivers? Waltrip leads by 173 votes over Bill Elliott.
I saw that. And Earnhardt gets the car sideways one more time.
Rudd to the inside. Second place Rudd trying to put Earnhardt a lap down. key play in this race if he can contain it.
Well, Rudd is trying to get by so he can sail after Neil Bonnett, because Bonnett, meanwhile, is pulling away from Ricky Rudd while he's back there pulling around with Dale Earnhardt.
About 3.5 seconds between first and second place.
Well, I don't mean that literally fooling around, but...
Well, trying to get by.
Trying to get by, and that's exactly right. Now he's pulled alongside and going down in turn one. We'll see what happens.
Earnhardt doesn't want to give it up. He's trying with everything he's got to stay there. Look at him try. Average speed, 125.501 miles per hour. That's topping the 1974 record of 121.6 by Petty. We could get a record out of this race.
I think we could, because we've had a few caution flags, but they've been very brief. Just two or three lap caution flags.
Further back in the field, Ruttman 9th, Tillon 10th, Kyle Petty 11th, Alan Kulwicki 12th, Strader is 13th, Beerswald 14th, Harrington 15th. Six cautions thus far in the going. As this track is a car eater.
Well, Harry Gant almost lost the car that time. Went in the third corner, trying to make up ground, was unable to do so.
So there's car number 15. Still staying in that second position. Walter third, Gant is fourth, and we're getting down to those last 50 laps to decide the American 500.
We're getting down to show and tell time in this Nationwise 500, and the guy we're watching is Neil Bonnett, who started in the back with a fast car and has put it out in front and is keeping there. Earlier we bragged on Dale Earnhardt's crew and Morgan Shepherd's crew because they hadn't laid a wrench on their cars all day. They were running right up there at the front. Morgan broke, Earnhardt's ignition went south, and Earnhardt is now scrambling for position while Shepherd is out of the race. Neil Bonnett and Darrell Waltrip's cars are prepared by Junior Johnson. Junior is going to make a chassis adjustment on Darrell's car late in the race on the final pit stop. We'll find out in a moment what Neil Bonnett's crew are going to do. The point is this. They work on their cars all day long, and every time they stop, they make them better. And late in the race, here's where you find them, first and third. Let's see what's going to happen with Bonnett's car as we go to Chris Economaki on pit road.
I'm with Tim Brewer, Neil Bonnett's crew chief. Well, you're all through, aren't you, Tim? He's not going to come in again, I gather. But what does he say about the condition of the car?
That's not a word.
Really?
Not a word.
I guess it's okay then, huh?
I wouldn't say that, Chris. You know, we've had a pretty bad year. We're just kind of holding our breath right now.
You got your fingers crossed?
Everything else.
Okay. Tim Brewer can't believe his car's out in front. He's Neil Bonnett's crew chief, and we'll see whether he can take a deep breath a little bit later on this afternoon. Back to you, Ken.
Bonnett, laps running down. Under 50 to go to finish it up here this afternoon. Hey, there's a great story. There is Charlie Bobtail Baker, the trucker. One of the great champions of truck racing. Drives those big 16,000-pound tractors. He's won two tractor races here at Rockingham. He's also the guy that launched a tractor in Old Kenworth right out of the park at Pocono, Pennsylvania, end over end. He said, hey, after you've rolled a 16,000-pound tractor, I'm ready for anything. He came out here today. This is a third or fourth race. He ran a couple of short tracks for Henley Gray. And Bobtail Baker out of Pennsylvania, his dad was a trucker, he's a trucker, and the trucking fans of America are seeing the great potential here for the future. He's held his own all day, so he's just going to run an easy race and try to finish. 20th place for Charlie Baker.
That's terrific. I've never seen one of those bobtail races or bobtail truck races, whatever they call those things, but I can't even drive one of those things, so he's impressive.
Well, his wife Robin's here, and she's a whole lot happier having him drive these things than drive those big tractors at 114-mile-an-hour average, which is what he won at here in Rockingham last time he took one. Average speed now is 125.690, and it is a new mark, Petty's mark. May go off the books this afternoon as Neil Bonnett continues the drive, continues the assault. He's on the beachhead now, trying to land it, with Ricky Rudd right behind him, Darrell Waltrip following, Gant is in there, Baker. Those five have stayed in that lead lap throughout the last half of this race. Gosh, it'd be great to see it turn around for Neil Bonnett this afternoon.
I don't know if one race could make a season, but I'll tell you one thing, it would sure help. Because as Tim Brewer said a moment ago, hey, we've been in this position before. Yeah. We haven't won anything, so let's just wait before this thing's over before we jump up and down with joy.
Very cautious Tim Brewer. 45 races since Bonnett has won at North Wilkesboro back in 85. They've got their fingers crossed. Not giving anything away, not showing any elation, just trying to get with it. Meanwhile, Ricky Rudd 2 7/10 of a second back in that second position. Waltrip third. There you see, to go back to second place, and Ricky Rudd. How about it, Ricky? Is this a Ford or a Chevy track?
Well, I don't really think it makes a difference whether it's a Ford or a GM. It really determines how well you set the car up. If the car is balanced well, if you got the right spring combination under the car. You know, all these cars are making horsepower about the same. The GM maybe has a little bit more bottom end acceleration. A track like this, it might be a slight advantage for the GM car, but nothing that I can see that's going to make a big difference.
A Ford sandwiched between two Chevys. I guess the Chevy fans will say that's a thorn between two roses.
I suppose you're right. Pretty good line, Ken Squire.
Okay, we're down now to where have any of those five got to come back in the loop?
No, they do not. This it. If Darrell Walter can get by his second spot, then something should happen to Bonnet, and it usually does. He wins.
32 laps left. 32 to go. Waltrip closing up. There's Baker being lapped. Bobtail Baker goes down another lap. Sorry, that must be Wallace running slowly. He's been in and out of the garage area. Battle is for second position. Waltrip takes the low line in car number 11. You're watching it live here on the Superstation, WTBS. We'll be with you at Riverside, California. If you can't take the journey out to the West Coast, be with us for the action of the finale. Here's Waltrip down to the bottom. Waltrip going wheel to wheel with Ricky Rudd. Rudd on the high side, Waltrip on the low side, down across the start-finish line into turn one. Into the blazing sun, blind there for just a moment, and still wheel to wheel. Rudd pulls back in front. Darrell won't let go. Tethered right there on the bottom of the racetrack. Into the back straightaway. Ricky Rudd at number 15 has the lead by about 5 feet. Back comes Waltrip into turn number three. It's a good one.
This is where Waltrip made all the advantage just a moment ago. This time Rudd able to stay a little lower on the racetrack. And looks like Rudd got through the corner a little bit better that time than Darrell Waltrip did.
Ken Schrader deployed just in front of the car number 9. His Ford. They move around, come up on Schrader. Will Waltrip have to lift? Indeed, Rudd runs right down to the 90 car to give himself just a couple of seconds of breather here. Here's Waltrip back. Running the same line for a moment. Does not look outside. Stays right there. Back to the stripe. Several much slower cars in front of them in turn number one this time.
Well, that's a problem that Darrell Waltrip has right now is those slower cars. If he gets alongside Ricky Rudd, Ricky's just going to run in behind one of the slow cars.
2 8/10 of a second remaining between first and second as Bonnet tries to become the 13th different winner of 1986 on the most competitive circuit in the world, the Winston Cup Circuit. We'll be back for the finish of the Nationwise American 500 shortly. Leading Ricky Rudd and Darrell Waltrip running second and third, and Harry Gant closing in fourth. Looks like we're getting down to a pretty good finish here today to decide it all in the Nationwise American 500. For other results around the country, let's go to the GM Goodwrench report. Here's Bob Barcher.
Thank you, Ken, and pardon the shades, folks, but you can see the drivers aren't the only ones having to deal with an autumn sun here at Rockingham. The longest motorcycle race in history is underway right now at Daytona International Speedway in Florida. The AMA Paul Revere 250 at Daytona was rained out back on July 4th. Qualifying stood, but the leading Team Hammer failed to show for today's race, so it's anybody's ballgame down there at Daytona. In Speedway bike competition, a national champion has been crowned. It happened under the lights at Costa Mesa, California.
The national title was decided in part by hard crashes. Sam Ermolenko knocked the front wheel out from under Bobby Boogaloo Schwartz. Bobby was okay, but the irate Ermolenko was disqualified. Schwartz cruised through the evening unbeaten, needing just one more win for the title when Steve Lucero muscled past to mar Boogaloo's perfect record and forced this title runoff with Bob Fetzing. Schwartz beat Fetzing off the line, and though Fetzing got downright upright in an attempt to catch him, after two straight years as a bridesmaid, Bobby Schwartz finally won his national title.
Well, the action continues at Road Atlanta in Georgia. Updating things there, Scott Lagasse has won the SECA Sports Renault National Championship, and George Faisal has added to a long string of Formula V titles. That's it for now on your GM Goodwrench Motor Week Illustrated Racing Update.
here in Rockingham. This is the man everybody's watching. In our live coverage, Neil Bonnet, with 19 to go, stays in front. Boy, what a show he has put on.
And that's Dick Trickle right behind him, folks, not Darrell Walker. The cars look very similar.
Dick Trickle, who's many laps down. Ricky Rudd is the second place man. Darrell Walker right there in third. And Gant, he's closing with a rush as we get down to the finish this afternoon. The Hank Williams Jr. story was to air immediately after this race will be shown at another date. Race continues to wind on. Another life. The Hank Williams Jr. story will not be seen immediately following this race today. Here's Bonnet first. Checking that interval another time between first and second place. Looks like Bonnet stays fairly secure in that number 12 car over the number 15 of Ricky Rudd in second. And Rudd is distancing Walker by about a half car length per lap. He's now got about a 7 car length advantage over Walker. Walker may fall back into the clutches of Harry Gant as we get down to the finish of this one.
Well, Ricky Rudd and the 3 car Dale Earnhardt is gaining on Neil Bonnet, but the problem is there's only 16 laps to go.
There you saw that interval between the second and third place man, Ricky Rudd, back to Darrell Waltrip, and now here comes Gant in number 33. Baker still the lead lap in fifth spot.
Ricky Rudd is gaining, but I don't know if there's going to be enough time.
The 11 car, Waltrip, fighting for the championship. Remember that Earnhardt is now shown in sixth position, so his try for the championship still very much on track. Remember, 3 tenth place finishes from here on, and he'd have it. He's up to 6 today.
What happened is all the cars have moved up high on the racetrack, with the exception of Neil Bonnet. And unless he gets up on top of the racetrack, I think Ricky Rudd's going to catch him.
Well, there's Rudd, number 15. He's got his war bonnet on, so he's picked up apparently. Looking for Neil out there in the first spot. It's been a rough year for Bonnet. Remember, he crashed the Daytona 500 and crashed in consecutive races at Atlanta and Bristol. Ricky Rudd is trying to catch him right now.
By our tally here, Ricky Rudd has picked up a full second on Neil Bonnet in the last 10 laps. At that rate, he would in fact catch Neil Bonnet right at the end of the race, and we'd have a dogfight for the finish. I think these two guys, and all of you on the broadcast team, need to be thinking about this. These guys are both very much in contention for champion spark plug racer of the race, and we may decide that one right at the start-finish line. One note about Neil Bonnet, he must have a mixed emotion here, because we talked earlier a couple of times about that $150,000 for the Winning Circle program. Ricky Rudd's car number 15 is already on that program for next year, but the Neil Bonnet number 12 car, owned by Junior Johnson, has not yet won a race this year. If he wins it today, Junior gets the $150,000. Meanwhile, Bonnet goes to the number 75 car. They need all the money they can get, and they lost their shot at that money when Morgan Shepherd blew up today. Let's go to Jerry Garrett on pit road.
Well, Dave, we were just talking down here to Bud Moore, Ricky Rudd's crew chief, and he says that Ricky's car is handling pretty good, but he thinks he's going to run out of laps.
Down toward 10 laps to go, next time by. Bonnet in front, badly hurt at Pocono this year, kept him out of the Talladega 500, but he sure looks like a champion right now. Neil Bonnet, long shadows, final moments here this afternoon at Rockingham. In the Nationwise American 500, Neil Bonnet looks like he's on his way.
Well, I'm sure his crew is keeping him abreast of exactly how much Ricky Rudd is gaining. If the car is working on the bottom of the racetrack, I suppose that's where Neil needs to be. Darrell Walker went back down to the bottom of the racetrack just a few laps ago and was able to pull away from Harry Gant. So maybe there is something on the bottom of the racetrack that I'm not seeing.
Well, there again, you saw for just a moment that interval. Rudd is closing, but I don't think he has time to get there.
It's going to be awfully close. 8 laps to go this time by. 8 laps to go right now.
A lot of battle-fatigued equipment. And the two cars up in front relatively unscathed after 500 miles in this mile track. There's the number 12 out in front. And again, you saw just how much time, how much space has to be made up by Ricky Rudd in his effort to overtake Neil Bonnet. It would be great to see Bonnet get himself a victory again. There's the Earnhardt car directly behind him in sixth spot. Waltrip is in third. So Waltrip will pick up a few points. Not that many. Came in here with a 159-point interval. They both led the race, so they've equalized that part of it.
Waltrip will only gain about 15 points, so we'll go to Atlanta with a 144-point lead.
Earnhardt getting tougher to beat as we get down to these final moments. But what a heartbeater it was when he came on pit road. And we didn't know but what was going to be over for him this afternoon, and that would really push Earnhardt further back. Six laps to go. Bonnet in first. And he has enough of an advantage, so unless there's some sort of a miscue, a lap car darts out where it doesn't belong. A cylinder starts to go away. Tire starts to equalize or any of that myriad of activity coming on.
Five laps to go. Harold Kinner just signaled Neil Bonnet. Five laps to go. And as I said a moment ago, something usually happens to Neil Bonnet, but he hasn't been this close all year. Just five laps.
There's Waltrip, third place.
He can't make a run at Ricky Rudd. If he could, he needs those 5 points. But it looks like Rudd is pulling away from him. Darrell is not gaining. Rudd is gaining.
Rudd's trying to close up on that leader. That's going to be tough.
He's not doing it either, Ken. He's trying, but Neil Bonnet has opened up the tap just that little bit. The interval is stable now at 2.6 seconds. Rudd peeled a second off of it. Bonnet team told him it was happening. Bonnet got on the pedal, and the interval is stable. Neil Bonnet's got this one won if she'll come home for it.
Ricky Rudd right there in second spot, but the man that they're watching is Bonnet out in front in that number 12 car. He stays right there. His best finish previously, third. In 1982, and he's been trying since 1977 to win this race. Well, I would say he's got it snarled if he can just hold on here these last two or three laps.
I think you're exactly right. Two laps to go this time by Harold Kinder gives him the signal. Just two laps. And Rudd is still too far back to come up and make a run at Neil Bonnet in the last two laps.
Since 79, he's had four crashes in this race when he made every effort to win it. But right now, after a third and 82 and a fourth and 83, it looks like it may be coming around Harold Kinder, taking that white flag in his right hand, about to put it out. It's down, and the last lap is underway for Neil Bonnet. Bessemer, Alabama, going down into turn number one. Last circulation around this better-than-mile track. He'll have himself a new record if it all hangs together. Beautiful race for Bonnet today, and what a surprise. A good surprise for Neil Bonnet. Here he is for Tim Brewer and company, who had a disappointing season. Great way to come back. Neil Bonnet wins his 16th Winston Cup race by 2.5 seconds over the Ford Thunderbird. Ricky Rudd, Darrell Waltrip will complete today in third. Harry Gant is in fourth, and Buddy Baker is in fifth. It's been a race of surprises, but aren't they all?
They sure are, and the biggest position of all is Dale Earnhardt able to get back to sixth spot, so Darrell Waltrip only gains 15 points on him.
Slowing down, you'll get to meet the winner in just a moment. Neil Bonnet coming in after this great victory this afternoon over Ricky Rudd, who pulled up alongside for just a moment to give him a salute. Here he comes. Easing down. There's the Earnhardt car already back. Well, that's a sight that's good to see.
It sure is.
Waltrip,
it's been a long season for Neil Bonnet.
Benny Waltrip now trails Earnhardt by 144 points. That's unofficial. That's a quick tabulation right here.
Well, that's about one race. If we go to Atlanta, Earnhardt has a problem early, and Darrell Waltrip wins the race or runs in the top three. They're even going into Riverside.
Headed for victory lane, Neil Bonnet. Been since early 85. Got to feel good. Hurt, and I mean really hurt at Pocono. Here's Jerry Garrett.
Well, we're down here right now with Darrell Waltrip, and Darrell's a long, tough day, but he didn't do too bad in the points, as it turned out.
I finished anyway. You know, we gained a few. We needed to gain a bunch, so I don't know if we did or not.
I guess you gained about 20. Does that help you?
No, not really.
Your teammate Neil Bonnet did you a favor by keeping Dale a lap behind so you could get a few points, though, I guess.
He did. Well, I'm glad for him.
Okay, Chris Economaki has his teammate the winner.
Hey, Neil, congratulations. Yeah, with one great drive. We got to know with this kind of season you had, what you were thinking about those last five laps.
Well, J.B. Raines and the guys built the motors. I knew that thing would run all day. He's been giving me good stuff. I've wrecked the car some this year. We've had some bad luck, but Budweiser, Valvoline, or Kentucky Fried Chicken, they stuck with us. It's been a heck of a year.
I'll take a drink there. Did you have any frights or any scares along the way, Neil?
Well, I raced at Rockingham today, so we had plenty of them. There's a bunch of close calls, but the guys just worked super in the pits all day, and we tried to keep our nose clean all day and have a good car at the end.
Well, you know what this does? This puts you in the Winston next year, which you weren't in before today's race. And you're the 13th man to win this year, and that sets a NASCAR record. Never before have more than 12 people won in a season, so it's going to be a memorable day for you.
I'm looking forward to Winston. It's a heck of a race for it. That 13 must be lucky.
Okay, now, there you have the winner, Neil Bonnet. Back to you, Ken Squire.
Neil Bonnet, who won his first race in his 33rd try in Winston Cup competition at the Richmond Fairgrounds Raceway in a half mile, and then, of course, went on to Super Speedway wins. Now comes back at Rockingham today and finishes on the perfect note, as he just was unbeatable in that last half of the race. Been interesting to see what would have happened had Tim Richmond been able to hang on, or Morgan Shepherd, or had not Dale Earnhardt. But that's another story for another race.
Well, my hat's off to Neil Bonnet and the entire crew, Ken Squire, because that 12 car is going away. It will not exist after this race, after this year. Junior Johnson will only have one car next year with Terry Labonte as the driver. So it'd be easy for those guys to lay down and quit because there's nothing there next year. But they didn't. They won the race today.
No quitters there. Back to Jerry Garrett.
Okay, we're down here with Dale Earnhardt. I guess you finished seventh today. That didn't hurt you too bad. Daryl finished third.
I think we were sixth, weren't we?
Yeah, sixth. Okay, they're confirming that now with scoring. That doesn't hurt you too bad.
No, if the ignition hadn't went out, we would have finished ahead of them. So, you know, my pit crew changed that real quick, and, you know, that Wrangler Goodrich crew just keeps on plugging along there. They beat all the guys out of pit several times a day, and, you know, it did just a good job for us today. The car was real good. Neil could have beat us, I believe, if it had been a race-to-race situation. I don't think I could have beat Neil if I think I'd have finished second. But still, we were better than anybody else. Neil got a good set of tires that time, and I probably didn't get a good set.
Okay, thanks a lot.
So there's Dale Earnhardt, still very much in command of this Winston Cup Championship battle. Two races to go. And we'll be back with more of the story and the details on this afternoon's Nationwise American 500 after these words.
Spark plug, racer of the race. If we find out if the TBS broadcast team really knows what they're talking about. Everybody gets one vote, fellas. I'll tally them up down here. I think we should start with wisdom before the beauty up in the booth. Let's go to Chris Economaki, who watched from pit road today. Chris, who do you think? Champion spark plug, racer of the race?
Well, I like the way Tim Richmond waited 48 laps to get his car fixed and then went back out and drove just as fast later as he did at the beginning. He gets my vote, Tim Richmond.
That's a nice call. I want to hear from Jerry Garrett, who's talked with Dale Earnhardt, perhaps the biggest winner of the day in one sense. Jerry?
Well, Dale kept her going, but I would have to vote for Harry Gant to keep that ill-handling thing on the track the whole race and to finish on the lead lap. What an accomplishment.
It was spectacular indeed. The best view of this place comes from the top of the rock, and the guys who watched it up there today certainly will have an opinion. I want to hear from Ken Squire.
Oh, racer of the race has got to be Earnhardt. No question about it. I mean, he made up a lap. He was just as tough as he could be. And if he hadn't had a little ignition problem, he'd have been all the way up there. He never quits.
And Benny Parsons, you get the next to last vote, my friend.
You're the beauty, Benny.
Well, I've got to agree with Jerry Garrett because, I mean, Harry Gant's job that he did today, keeping the car in the lead lap, and at one time having the fastest car on the racetrack, hey, unbelievable. He had the car sideways, 492 laps. He must have had it sideways 262 times. So, hey, Harry Gant, my hat's off to you, baby. I'm glad I was up here and you was out there.
We pick the racer of the week every week on Motor Week for the Champion Spark Plug Company. And when I have the deciding vote, I always make the vote on the basis of the guy who has to drive his race car, not so much on the basis of the championship he won, the title that he earned. I will take nothing away from Neil Bonnet here this afternoon. I think Dale Earnhardt put it right on the head. Neil had a good handling race car. He got a good set of tires. He drove it magnificently. The guy who battled all day long, the guy who raced this racetrack, raced his heart out, was Harry Gant. And Harry is our champion spark plug racer of the race.
Okay, you guys, Harry Gant, huh?
Take that.
All right.
What do you know about it, right?
How about that guy right there?
Hey, I tell you what, he did do a super job. And Neil Bonnet, it's been a long year. I'm glad to see you back in victory lane. Now, in Atlanta, I need the same treatment, if you guys would just help me out a little bit.
We'll do. We'll take a look at the final standings here today. Racer of the race, that was Harry Gant in car number 33, who took one of the most ill-handling cars and brought it home in the top five, finishing in fourth position. A look at the statistics on this Nationwise American 500 in a moment. Here at Rockingham, 18 cars finished the distance of 22 cars finished the distance. 18 retired before it was over today. There were 22 lead changes between eight drivers. Caution periods came to a total of six before the day was done. And the way they finally came across, Neil Bonnet the winner, Ricky Rudd in second, Waltrip in third, Harry Gant fourth, and Buddy Baker fifth. A lap down in the sixth position was the Dale Earnhardt organization. And they still hold 144 points unofficially over Waltrip for second place in the Winston Cup standings with two races remaining. In seventh was Bill Elliott. Eighth was Richard Petty today. Ninth was Joe Ruttman. Finishing 10th was Kyle Petty. 11th was Bobby Hillen. 12th was Alan Kulwicki. 13th was Mike Waltrip. 14th was Schrader. In 15th was Dick Trickle. 16th, Eddie Bierschwall. 17th, Arrington. 18th, Bob Dale, Charlie Baker, the truck driver. And rounding out the group was Rusty Wallace, well down. Let's go to Jerry Garrett.
Well, we're down here with a second-place finisher in this race, Ricky Rudd. It looked like you were going to catch the leader there for a while, but he just ran out of laps, I guess.
Well, I'd like to congratulate Neil Bonnet, first of all. Those guys have been looking for a victory for quite a while, and I'm glad to see him get it. I'd like to have seen him gotten it on a different day and let us have the win today, but we'll take second. You know, for a while there, it looked like I might have had a shot at racing Neil. Earnhardt had gotten in between us, and his car had been running good, but he lost some laps earlier. I had to try to get down on the inside of him to get up to Neil, and raced him about three or four times down on the inside, and when I did, I smoked the tires, lit the tires, spun them off the corner couple of times, and after I did that I couldn't get the traction and I just fell back, and then I tried to help, had to hold Darrell off a second, but might have had a shot at him, I don't know. He was awful tough at the end.
You've done yourself a lot of good in the points lately. You've really been moving up now.
Well, you know, the Motorcraft 14 has done a real good job all year. There's been a couple of accidents that I found myself in three or four times this year, and it really hurt us in the point standings. Now we're up into a pretty good fourth place position, but there's about three or four cars within a few points of where we are, and it's a quite a battle for that fourth place position, because it can mean about $150,000 in this next couple of races. So we have our race going on, just like Waltrip and Earnhardt have their race going on up front.
Okay, well, congratulations, Ricky. Let's go back to Dave Despain in the STP Pit Communications Center.
Well, indeed, at every Winston Cup stock car race, there are a variety of races going on within the race, and the True Value Hardware people's calculators are absolutely smoking, because they've been sorting down through all this complicated point standing to determine who was the hardest charger from green flag to checkered flag here today. System works like this. You have 5 points to lead a lap, four for second, three for third, and so on down. So the numbers get kind of complicated. But the guy at the top of the heap, it's small consolation. Darrell Waltrip was the hard charger today over Shepard, Earnhardt, Bonnet, and Richmond, who all led, some of them for long periods of time. Won't do Darrell any good in the championship chase. Earnhardt still leads in the run for the $25,000 True Value Hard Charger year-end award. Let's go to Chris Economaki.
Well, I'm with Harry Gant. Harry, all race long, Benny Parsons was saying, my God, Harry's got a car that isn't handling, it isn't working, he's working his head off. Oh, he's up there near the wall. Did you have a tough day at the wheel?
Yeah, I had a tough day. I couldn't hook up to the racetrack today, no matter what. At the last, we was running pretty good with Darrell, and I know we didn't need no caution cone. They put four new tires on. I was history there.
Are you smiling? Are you worn out?
No, not worn out. Just a little disgusted that we didn't really run any better today.
Okay, congratulations, Harry Grant, and back to Ken Squire.
Well, the Wall Street Journal ran a big story about Buck Baker the other day and said stock cars don't have speedometers, but it's easy to tell when you've reached respectable speed. Your shoes start to smolder. There was a lot of shoes smoldering today here at Rockingham before it was over. Our thanks to everyone that made this possible, the folks at Rockingham, L.G. DeWitt and Frank Wilson, and the folks from NASCAR for their help as well. For Benny Parsons, Dave Despain, Chris Economaki, Bob Barsha, Jerry Garrett, I'm Ken Squire here at Rockingham, where Neil Bonnet reigns victorious.
This TBS Sports presentation of the Nationwise 500 has been brought to you by Champion, makers of Copper Plus, America's best spark plug. And by today's Chevrolet, the heartbeat of America, who invites you to put yourself in an 87 Chevrolet and listen to your heartbeat. And by Budweiser, Beechwood Age with that distinctively clean, crisp taste that makes Budweiser the king of beers. For all you do, this Bud's for you.
The 19th...